Ladies and gentlemen, welcome to the Archon Team League Championships. My name is Frody, and today I'm joined by Noxious from Team Complexity and Savitz from Team Liquid to bring to you another day in the action of this $250,000 league. So let's go ahead and start off the day by welcoming you guys and the entire panel of the casting desk. So Noxious, how are you doing today?
I'm doing great. I've actually not been able to watch yesterday's matches as a result of some problems with my internet connection, but I've kept track of the win losses, so that's kind of interesting.
Well, yesterday we had some pretty intense series. One of the closest ones was a 6-5. Unfortunately, it didn't go Liquid's way, but it was pretty intense nonetheless. So, Savitz, how are you feeling so far? Not just with the league, but overall over there in Finland.
I'm awesome. I mean, it was a bit disappointing yesterday, I'm not gonna lie, but I can't blame show too much. I mean, that same thing happened to me last week, and I think in a lot of the games, like for example the last game, he got a bit unfortunate with not drawing Warzone Commander at all. Mm-hmm. And we're still like as a team, we're really like close together, and I think we can go far. For today's match, I'm so hyped to be casting. I'm really happy to be here.
Yeah, that's right. Today's matches are going to be really fun. We have Forsen Boys versus Archon. For anybody who doesn't know, Forsen Boys is a team of mercenaries with Forsen at the captainship, along with Chaki and Oskaka. And then we're going to also have Team Celestial going to be making an appearance and try to grab their first win of the tournament up against Value Town, who's also done really well themselves. So taking a little preview about what we can expect to see, we have... Oh, well, we have two priests. That's something. Whoa. I didn't expect.
Whoa,
not just one priest, but two priests. And to add on top of that, these guys have the same exact classes. Whoa. All right. Wow.
That's like, that's no surprises except for the priest. I think that those five other classes. Are we missing something? Because I'm actually looking at this. Also rogues.
Druid's not here.
Druid's not there. So I guess they wanted to dodge that. Druid is one of those lower tier picks. I played it yesterday, and a few others did as well. But it's definitely one of those that you don't really want to play, but you have to play something. You can't play Patron six times.
Yeah, there's I think Gar played Shaman yesterday, unless I'm mistaken. Anyway, so you've got like Shaman, Priest, Druid at the bottom, like kind of the lower tier. What's the other class that we're missing here? Like, we're obviously missing another one.
Paladin. Oh, there we go. Thrown in, and the mid-range Paladin has also been struggling a little bit here and there. Just you know, sometimes going 50% or less.
Yeah, so it's kind of interesting because you've got 9 classes, and you've got 5 of them that you know you want to bring, and 4 other ones that you have to rotate out of that 6th slot that you're just not sure is really going to perform very effectively.
That's right. Yeah. That's right. So guys, we're going to go ahead and get ready for our first match very soon. But before we do that, we want to show you guys a week 1 and 2 recap video for anybody who didn't get a chance to tune in. Here's a little video to catch you up to speed. Yeah, this is a play to try and kill your opponent. And he's really hoping that this is like maybe explosive trap so we can get that bounce back.
Correct.
Oh, Trump is so surprised, the freezing trap out of nowhere.
Is your fireball?
Oh, fireball is it. That allows him to kill him. And he actually ends up beating the druid player. But he's got the lethal.
Yeah, I know. But I'm trying to think. Logo.
Is everyone really, really getting in here?
Oh!
No!
Just no lethal. Because I thought that you had like 12 more damage coming right in from those patrons. Oh, wow.
It's a 3-3 didn't attack.
That's too many cards.
Right? Yeah, I was going to say that's like getting a bit maybe too high. Maybe just cycle the inner rage and kill the Doomsayer.
That's really nerfed. Patron Roy.
Oh!
What happened?
Yeah, that's with Shaman.
Exciting. With Shaman. Thinking of Grim Patron Warrior.
At 4.
Oh, no!
Okay. Wouldn't have mattered, but give him gas. So Harrison. Harrison allowed him to draw that second.
Quick enough right in this matchup.
Yeah. Life coach, you're on Patron camera. Woo! Look at that. 31 damage from other Berserkers. All right, so those standings at the very end of the video obviously have updated a little bit since then. Temple Storm did grab their first win. Cloud9 was a team that they defeated, and they fall to 1-2, evening out the score. And Liquid is barely ahead of them, too, but they're probably the top of the bottom pack right now because you guys have the biggest tiebreaker score. A lot of funny moments there. Noxious, you're pointing out that most of those errors seem to be coming specifically from the Patron deck, which is quite amusing.
Yeah. It's one of those decks that I think, you know, we've been talking about this, where the rope is kind of the biggest factor very often in tournament play, because they end up thinking the turn through, and then sometimes they just don't get the win as a result of it. So it's kind of funny to look at from a caster and viewer perspective in general, I think.
The animations take such a long time. It's a really sensitive deck to play. So many ways you can mess it up, and you don't want to miss lead on a big league like this. And it feels really bad when it happens, like we saw there.
Yeah. Oh, yeah, I can imagine. They missed this one moment that I was really looking forward to. It's when Tiddler missed an attack with the Patron as resulted in kill Life Coach. Life Coach ended up dropping his own War Song, Unstable Ghoul, and Frothing Berserker and killing Tiddler the very next turn. It was like down to the rope, too, because you weren't sure the animations were taking forever. It was really funny and close.
Yeah, it was like the donation, basically. That's how we called it back. It was like a donation of a win to Life Coach after the miss lethal. Because it flooded the board, right? And the ghoul could actually get the AoE whirlwind to hit for enough to give the kill with frothing.
Yep, that's right. And that also leads directly into our conversation about some of the undefeated players. A few of that has changed as well. Life Coach ended up dropping a couple games yesterday, rebounded strongly, and finished for Nihilum. So the list of players who have come out strong 4-0 for the team is starting to get smaller and smaller. One of them is Chalky from Team Force and Boys. And we have a video about him to preview it for the last coming match before we get ready for Force and Boys versus Archon. So enjoy.
Hi, I'm Keaton Gill, Chalky, and I'm on Team Forsen Boys. Well, I've known Forsen since way back in the Fight Night days, and he needed to scrap together a team, so I was one of his choices. I think the format's really interesting. We're going to see a lot of different classes since we have to bring out 6 of them, and each player's kind of individual strengths are going to be emphasized more so than kind of the Conquest weakest stack link thing. Yeah, I think the Forsen boys are gonna do pretty well. We'll bring it home. To all the fans of me and the Forsen boys, thanks for your support. Hope you guys enjoy, and hope we can put on a good show.
All right, well, Forsen boys comes in as one of the teams on top. If they win, they join Nihilum as the only undefeated team so far, which might come as a surprise to some people, considering that they don't have the expected team synergy. It's like, well, where does Chalky and Oskaka really become good friends with Forsen? I've never seen them on their stream together on the Skype calls, but these guys are working really well. Savitz, is this surprising to you at all, considering their lineup of players?
No, I think they have a really solid lineup. Oskaga is a very strong player. He's not that well known to the big audiences because he hasn't had that many appearances in a tournament stream. But he did do quite well in the Seed Story Cup too, and finishing second, so only lose the finals 3-4. Great player. Chalky also has been on fire lately. I mean, 3 great players. What can really go wrong?
Yeah, that's true. I think Conquest really highlights the team aspect of this too, because you're only as strong as the weakest part of your lineup, whether it's a player or it's a class. And if you minimize the weaknesses of your players, then all you're exposing yourself is a weakness of the class, which is just subject to the metagame. And even then, your team might discover a deck that might actually be good, depending on how your lineup functions. So In this scenario, it shouldn't surprise too many people that Force and Boys is doing well. But granted, it's still the very beginning. 2 matches are done, but there's 6 more to go. And you never know how the tables might turn. There's still plenty of room for a team to make a strong comeback or a team with high expectations to start off good, but then end up falling a little bit later.
Yeah, it's. I think what's really unexpected about it, I think the Force and Boys is that those players, Chalky and... and Forsen, you really don't see them. Like, they, Shockey's got a lot of exposure recently. I mean, I think he's been doing a lot better than he used to, but he was a little bit of a smaller name, and Forsen's been mostly streaming, right? And people very often associated with the laid-back kind of streaming attitude that he's got, but as far as tournament play goes, when he actually starts caring about the win, I think that's when you start seeing the competition inside of him just pop out. It's pretty crazy.
All right, well, looks like it's time to begin the first game here. Mage versus Priest. Forsen on the Mage, 6-0 on the Priest. And we've been seeing a couple of trends here. The first is that a lot of teams really want to get some of these, quote, weaker classes out of the way early. They start off with Paladin, they start off with Priest, sometimes even the Shaman. And another thing, too, is that Forsen... The POV was interesting to me. Forsen's also been playing a ton of Freeze Mage, and this should not be surprising at all. Looks like Team Archon is coming for that, though. A Kazan Mystic.
Wow.
I'm liking this lineup. Lot. Yeah, wow. I really like the Kazan Mystic. I think the idea of bringing Priest here is that it's going to beat Hunter somewhat consistently. And if you sprinkle in the Kazan Mystic, not only is it good in that matchup, but it's also going to beat the mages that are everywhere. A lot of people are playing Freeze Mage, so that definitely makes sense. I kind of like that.
It's a really tough matchup for Priest in general, but that Kazan is such a huge deal. It can completely turn around the game. It can win the game alone.
Timing is going to be really key. Sometimes you feel like you have to seize the board, and then Kazan Mystic has to go for his 50-50, but you want to isolate the ice block specifically, because that's ultimately what Priest struggles with, that you really can take your time being able to draw your cards because Priest can't pressure you, and then you can go for the Alexstrasza. And Priest even has limited healing because no one's really playing the Antique Healbot or Holy Fire. And even then, Emperor Thorsen opens up more platforms for you. So this matchup has definitely not gone Priest's favor, traditionally speaking.
Yeah. Also, I think it's worth pointing out that based on that Kazan Mystic and what we were talking about, that it's targeted at Hunter potentially, I think it would make a lot of sense for the deck to also include the Healbot, which helps a lot in this matchup. I would expect it to be there.
Okay.
Yeah. I agree with you. I think it's a perfect. It's a perfect fit if that's what you're targeting at this point.
Yeah, I don't mind. I don't mind at all. And I think the very first iterations, because the Chinese version of the Priest, right? They loved playing Dark Bomb and even a Heal Bot thrown in there.
A Light Bomb. Yeah.
Oh, sorry,
I imagine it's
Light Bomb. Excuse me.
Yeah,
got my classes mixed up there.
That's a good time to play the Blood Mage for Cycle, just before the Cabal. Otherwise you have to ping it when you play it, if you're just cycling and not using it for the damage.
Yeah.
Oh wow, just the Emperor. Well, that's a huge draw.
He even got both Scientists out too before the Cabal, so... Pretty much the only thing the Cabal left in the deck is the Doomsayer and the Acolytes.
I don't think so. Yeah, I really don't see that Doomsayer coming out for the Priest. What if he plays like a Wii Spellstopper, man? Like, that could be the craziest 4-drop ever.
I don't know. I think that card's still missing a little bit before it becomes really good, mainly in the stats department. But, I mean, this card does plenty by itself. Emperor Thorsen reducing the cost of Alexstrasza and a couple of burn. There's 15 damage follow-up to Alexstrasza already, and if Forsen picks up another piece of burn, I can see him trying to go for the offensive very early on.
Yeah, Sixo really needs some cards here, I think. He has a lot of cards that don't do all that much right now. The Kazan obviously is a great one to have, but getting those Thought Steals, potentially stealing something of value, getting also the maybe the Cleric combos to draw for that heal, but just dig for it. Because the combo, like we said, the Alexstrasza and the burn might be coming really, really soon. Usually you don't see it this fast.
Yeah, the tricky thing is, if you steal the ice block, then it's almost better. Like, it sure denies your opponent the ice block, but in this case, it's almost a safeguard against the burn that he's going to be throwing at you. So it's forcing the mage to build up even more burn, and the only way he's going to have it is probably through an Archmage Antoninus generating more fireballs or getting the pyroblast. So I think, you know, stealing the ice block for defensive purposes, it's probably what we're going to be seeing soon.
Mm-hmm.
Oh, man. Sengen.
Yeah. Is that what a Doomsayer no yet? No way.
Oh man, what if he plays, let's assume he plays Doomsayer and Archmage comes out.
He could go for the Doomsayer here if he wants to just go for the Alexstrasza straight away on the next turn. But this is so tough because of that Kazan, because if he goes for that Alexstrasza,
he's gonna get punished pretty hard.
The burn in his hand is really limited right now. I wouldn't mind a Gabal on the Doomsayer here to just prevent that.
Yeah, see, the funny thing about Cabal Shadow Priest on a Doomsayer, Luthor is also a valuable target too, is that it gives you one more time, and it gives you, like, your own terms, so it stalls out the Alexstrasza play. But you first have to predict that your opponent would have Alexstrasza for 8 mana for this to happen.
Yeah, and he had to have it before that that Emperor, so maybe a bit too risky there, not really worth it.
So we have to assume he's going to go for the Shadow Ward Death play. I mean, there's really no other line of play that's going to guarantee your safety, assuming he's got any type of burn in his hand. But if you don't do that, then you're exposing yourself. Well,
wow,
that's gonna be awfully close. Yeah, awfully close. Not quite there.
16 damage right now. If he picks up an Ice Lance or another Frostbolt, it's over.
Oh man, so close. And now he can't trigger the Ice Barrier to guarantee the Ice Block.
Well, he would have to go 50-50 at least.
Yeah. But I don't think he will. It depends if we see one fireball here. He might feel threatened.
I wonder. So, Holy Nova to heal, followed by Kazan Mystic. Oh, there's no minion played though, so it's not going to be relevant at all.
Yeah.
Wow. And what's also tricky too is that Sixo has to heal.
He's dead. Rest in peace.
He's dead now. That does it.
Yep. He doesn't predict this. So many spells, damage spells specifically, are the ones that are getting the cost reduced and being able to end the game here.
But after such an early Alex, I would expect maybe to be pressured into healing as fast as possible.
No, that was such a fast game from them. The priest had almost no time.
Yeah.
Like he had opportunities to play the Kazan earlier, but I like the decision to hold on to it for a little bit, like more surprise. But it didn't work out so well this time.
So he's gonna be locking his game with a freeze mage against the priest again. It's a pretty, I wouldn't say one-sided completely matchup. I thought the Kazan Mystic would really help swing the tides around, maybe modify the percentages, but it wasn't quite enough.
Well, that's what all it does, though. It helps improve the matchup. It doesn't guarantee anything. First, you have to draw it, and then second, you have to have the situation where it comes up. You know, so many times people have, like, a Harrison Jones, and that helps improve a lot of matchups against weapon classes, but then sometimes your opponents never draw weapons. Like, if you're against Warrior, they just don't ever get their weapons, or Hunter, they don't need Eaglehorn Bow to kill you sometimes. They just keep pressuring you without it. So there's situations that need to arise. There's two layers of those tech cards that need to arise.
Yeah, you're right.
Also, what's important to note is that Sixo also has shown that he has Kazan Mystic, and he lost, which is a really unfortunate circumstance because you can definitely guarantee that Forsen boys are also going to be trying to watch what's going on too on behalf of Forsen, so they're going to be paying attention to the stream on the delay, and they're going to know cards like the Kazan Mystic exist. So now, with that information, they can use that to their benefit, and Priest can even be more of a liability now if they single it out.
Yeah, so do you queue up like a Hunter now, because you don't want to play it against the Priest, and the Priest is not getting played again?
Well, played again, but you're afraid of the bench, I guess because you're afraid of the bench, you might not queue up Priest right away.
But are you afraid of it? Because even if the bench happened, they would still have 4 classes available.
Yeah.
So, I don't know. They might not be afraid of it just yet.
Yeah, just push through the Priest until it wins a game, and then you can actually start playing Hearthstone. Because that's basically the class you want to get out of the way in this specific lineup. And it's kind of interesting, though, that both teams brought Priest. Like, I'm still curious to see how Forsen boys build theirs, because we know kind of what Team Archon's Priest looks like.
Mm-hmm. Absolutely. I do want to point out that one of the most interesting things Strifeco said to me is that if you anticipate your opponent's not playing something. So, for example, if Archon doesn't want Sixo to potentially get benched and targeted, they can get away with trying to play classes that Sixo's decks would be good against. So, if Forsen, for example, was playing like a really tight Zoo deck and they're afraid of like the Oil Rogue and the Priest being good against that type of Zoo, then they can queue it up. In this case, Forsen boys also is tossing out their Priest, and it's up against a Rogue deck, which is one of the hardest matchups for Priest.
Yeah, that's one for Team Archon right there. They didn't. I'm pretty sure that Forsen Boys queued up the Priest thing, and they wouldn't. Archon wouldn't put six off play to play again, but they did, and with the Rogue. That's such a great matchup with Rogue.
Yeah, it's as good as it's gonna get, I think, for Team Archon here. The thing is, I'm really still curious to see how Shaki's deck is built. That's the one thing that's kind of an unknown factor at this point.
Can we take a second to appreciate that Shaki's playing Priest of all people?
I know.
In the Force,
it's Aggro Priest, man. I believe in it.
Aggro Priest. There is a version out there.
Shadow Bombs.
It's not as aggressive as you think it is, though. It's got like. Yeah. Death Lord still, but the whole point is that you have inner fire somewhere in there, and you do some pretty crazy stuff.
Yeah. Did you see that what? Crusher Priest recently with the inner fire and Stormwind Knight?
Seen it. It hit like top 10 in Chinese Legend Ladder recently. Yeah. I can show you the deck list. It's really funny. Maybe you should try it on stream, Savitz. You'd be one doing that.
Oh, yeah. I'm trying a lot of different stuff, so I'll check it out. just hoping one day, like, Shadow Bombers and Mind Blast would be a thing. But it just doesn't go well with the hero power at all to build it in an aggressive way.
Yeah. It's missing just a bit, though. Like, the deck feels like it's just short of being very functional. Because you can raise Hunters, but that's about the only class you can raise. Everyone else, you just kind of... don't sustain aggression long enough.
Yeah, it's because the Priest is too synergy-based to be aggressive. A lot of the cards that allow him to be aggressive require either situational things to happen, like the Zombie Chow and the Alchemized Soul Priest, or specifically that like their cards are better at building board and card advantage, which is not aligning to aggressive strategies. Like, Northshire Cleric is really good, but that's not really an aggressive strategy. It's more of like a board control... yeah, you know, card advantage strategy. So it's like all these different things, which is Priest probably just needs more tools in the end.
All right, so it looks like a slower type of Priest, obviously not the Shadow Bomber type.
Lothab is pretty huge, though. If he can ever get to the point where Rogue can't answer high health minions, if there's a couple of injured Blade Masters and maybe even like Death Lord that's out there and making sure that Rogue just has to spend two cards or more to remove it and it doesn't get anything of value back, then Lotheb can sometimes seal the deal, especially against a class that's dependent on spells like Rogue is.
Yeah. No, it's a really great swing card. The thing is, the hand from Xixo is looking pretty solid as well.
Yeah, and the hand from Chucky, not so good. Those Shadower Deaths are going to be dead for a long time.
Oh, man. Mm-hmm. Okay, so with that Goblin Auto Barber, that signifies that 6-0 is playing that list Mr. Yakut likes to run and a few other guys with Assassin's Blade. And if you don't have the Harrison Jones, that Assassin's Blade is going to be so devastating for Priest to deal with. It's going to be nuts.
Yeah, for sure. We'll see. I'm expecting some kind of tech cards, but is it more in the line of the Kazans or the Harrison? That we don't know.
I would have to guess the Harrison Jones, because if you expect Patron to be dominant, you know people will bring Hunter, and you also know Archon particularly loves Rogue. They have three players who are excellent at Rogue. They have Firebat, Zalay, and 6-0. So I think they would probably be geared more towards weapon. But I'm willing to be surprised. I mean, I could have said the same for guys like, that Archon predicting the same from Forsen Boys, but they brought Kazan.
Yeah, go ahead, sorry.
From my experience, it's a little bit like, against those class, like Patrons and even the Rogue, even if you run Harrison, you're still going to lose. So in that sense, I actually think that it would make more sense to gear it towards something else and just like accept the bad matchup, and because it's still extremely bad.
What if they went like a layer deeper Savitz? They have two Oozes, they have Harrison Jones, and they even, just for the heck of it, threw in a Bloodsail Corsair and just try to kill every single weapon possible.
You're laughing, but there's in the Vulcan League, there was this player called Kuvdon, I think a Finnish player, like fairly unknown, that came up with a lineup to counter Bunny Muffins, and he brought two Oozes, Harrison Jones, two heal bots, and some ridiculous healing to counter the Hunter that he expected. It was like absolutely insane.
Did it work?
Yeah, it worked. He won 2-0. Like, Bunny Muffins couldn't even move.
Wow.
It was beautiful.
That's pretty cool.
Oh, man. Well, I guess Lotheb isn't the most opportune time here, but it's the right time to play him, perhaps, because everything else feels pretty weak. Northshire Cleric has zero impact. And Alchemized Soul Priest is really valuable if you pick up Even on turn 6, you can use it with its hero power to pick things off. And then if you draw the Circle of Healing, obviously it becomes a really dominant board clear. So Lotheb seems to be the play, but you're not really loving this, are you, Savitz?
No. Everything was bad there. I think Lotheb was there. It's like the only play that makes you not fall too far behind for now.
Yeah, and if you're waiting to get a really good Light Bomb, the drawback, I guess, is in this specific case, the rogue player would have played Lotheb, and then Light Bomb would have just been shut down for an entire turn, so you would have taken like 15 more damage just for being a little too greedy. That's a good call.
I would expect a lot, but I think I'm not sure. What else could he do?
Auto Barber SI. I like Auto Barber SI, or yeah, it's all right.
He's going to get destroyed by Light Bomb though if he does that.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Yeah, the Lotep is the only play that doesn't lose him the game from what I think, because of the Light Bomb in Jackie's hand right now.
That's a decent turn for the Alcanai. A decent turn, not a great one. You could also play Northshire for card draw, I guess, if you're trying to push for that, but you're getting kind of vulnerable to board wipes after that, because you've got a pretty weak board against what they have. I think the thing that's going to make 6-0, Shaki decide how he wants to play this, is based on how much he trusts the Light Bomb to do what it has to.
Oh, yeah.
But, there's still, like, this overarching problem of, like, what happens if 6-0 draws Assassin's Blade? Does he just die in 2-3 turns?
Yeah.
He can't even stop Blade Flurries from happening, essentially, too. If his opponent camps on a high-damage weapon, which would be 4 at the moment.
But right now, there's not that much good stuff in 6-0's hand. He really needs more card draw. And, resilient minions, like, for example, the Piloted Strider. Those 3-3s and the 3-2... they're not going to be enough to win the game.
Yeah, I like the Light Bomb here. It's really giving Shaki a huge amount of flexibility as to when he wants to commit to any play. He lets his opponent overextend a little bit if he's going to do that. Like, the only way 6-0 is not overextending is if he's got a massive amount of burst, through Tinker's Sharp Sword and can push for damage right now. But then you can still, respond to that because you're not near death.
Yeah, and... Lotheb is already played, and
Okay. I don't mind this play. Everything else opens you up to Shadow Madness to clear your board, so this seems to be 6-0's best way to seize the board without opening up the Lotheb to potentially get wiped. Now, what's interesting enough is that, that also makes that Light Bomb is a clear here, and its opponent's only down to 2 cards, and Chalky's like, well, next turn might be the sprint turn, so maybe this is an opportunity for me to get the board back if my opponent has nothing to do.
Get the board back with that Northshire Cleric.
I think he's thinking about whether or not to drop the Cleric before Light Bombing, so potentially drawing for next... Oh, he's not Light Bombing. Okay.
I think his Light Bomb is the only way he can deal with another Azure Drake or other 4 attack creatures. It's like... He doesn't have the Shrinkmeister yet.
Mm-hmm. Makes sense. And also those Shadower Deaths in his hand are impossible to use if he doesn't cast one here. Oh. They're just going to be completely dead. So it makes sense to use the Death because of that.
Yeah, just and if your opponent had Burst, I guess he would have played it last turn, right? Like if he had the Tinker Sharp Sword and all the face damage, he would have probably done that last turn instead of trading his stuff away.
Yeah.
So yeah, it makes a lot of sense. He's going to get a pretty effective clear though with that Auto Barber. Oh, wow.
No.
Well, that doesn't solve everything. He just lost his Pyromancer, which would have been almost perfect. And Light Bomb is ill-timed or ill-fated because Azure Drake's about to come out afterwards. But then comes the question, if I save this Light Bomb, do I take too much damage for it to be irrelevant that I clear the board? He might just kill me through burn.
Yeah, it's a tough turn. Good call there, because he would even get wrecked by the Azure Drake if he didn't save the Light Bomb in this situation.
Right.
But the one Drake was already played, too. But there is the second one coming.
Yep. Alright, it's a pretty good position, though, for... I think both players look at their position and they feel like they're in an okay one. You know, this is the position where you almost wish you had Light Bombed after playing Northshire so the backstab couldn't apply to it, and you had to waste a weapon charge on it.
Haha. Like, but then you would be susceptible to the Goblin Auto Barber buff.
Mm-hmm.
Okay.
Oh, wow.
Well, this is what Light Bomb is best at. And you've dealt with most... Is there any other like minion that you really want to target with it? I mean, the Shredders are not even as powerful as you'd like it to be sometimes because it still gives a minion that sticks on the board. So I can't really imagine it targeting.
Dr. Boom.
Dr. Boom, I guess.
It's a bit faded out from the rogue list. Most rogues don't run it anymore. And he saw the Goblin Elder Barber. So I wouldn't expect the Dr. Boom to be there. So it seems to be the Light Bomb then.
Not to mention that he's got Shadow Ward Death and Cabal Shadow Priest. So
that's also true. Yeah, he does.
He can like steal.
Yeah, except he can't deal with three attack minions. You know, standard problem. Typical priest life.
Well, until he gets the Shrinkmeister, then that all of it can completely swing around. His opponent would be stuck with only spells. A single Shrinkmeister, I feel like, can turn around this entire game.
Yeah, and I think that the fact that he can heal himself every single turn from here on out is going to be a big problem. Because the rogue doesn't have any burst at the moment, so as long as Shaki keeps healing himself, the rogue's hero power is just not able to contest that.
Sprinter bust. Fan is okay. And it is sprint.
Oh, there it is. But it was only a matter of time. That's a great pick up, though, obviously. But I feel like the rogue did have more time than just this to draw it. That's the Assassin's Blade. Wow.
Oh my goodness. Oh, that's so much damage.
I think if he picks up prep next turn, he wins.
Yeah, because of the South Sea, right? I think.
Please actually, he might not need it. He can just use the regular weapon.
Yeah.
Yeah, he just takes up and deck and poison oil.
Because that's still 8. Look, you get 5 from the deckhand, and your weapon becomes 6, so that's 11. Oh, no, he still needs the blade
flurry.
Blade flurry is really big.
There's 2 of them in there.
Yep. So, if that's the case, then the prep allows him to put the Assassin's Blade, which still wouldn't be enough damage, I think. So this antique heal bot would have to survive, but that's idealistic to say the least.
Yeah, I mean, Shaki is probably worried about Blade Flurry. His minions are kind of getting low on health, and all it takes is one. He hasn't seen a single oil, so it's really just a matter of a little bit more damage pushing from Tixo to wipe the board completely.
This happens all too frequently when you're playing Priest, where you're like, well, sometimes I need to grab the board, or I definitely want to grab the board with cards like Akanai, but then I also lose my ability to heal, so, you know, from this point on, Akanai Soul Priest also might be a liability, to the point where my opponents can just take advantage of the fact that I can't heal. But at the same time, I think that kind of pressure is really needed, because Priest needs to make some kind of victory push here.
No, it's such a good turn.
This is such a sick turn here. He can even play Violet Teacher.
Violet Teacher before the poison to kill it.
That's so good. I think Sixto's feeling pretty confident. This is basically the power of Rogue. Like, we were talking about this just before. You said this is one for Team Archon. Well, I mean, it's kind of being exemplified in the way it turns out.
Yeah, they want the mind games in the big.
Oh, gosh. Second Teacher.
Welcome to hell, Priest.
Huh.
Yeah.
Well, that's somewhat helpful here.
Actually, it is very helpful. Yeah, you're right. But the thing is, it guarantees Thinker Sharp Sword all value because it won't spawn 1/1s now.
Yeah. If he clears both of us, he probably will.
Yeah, he's got a board clear here. I wonder if Chalky's seeing any opportunity to go aggressive. There's 7, 9, 11 damage this turn, and one of his minions is really hard to remove. It'll have 9 health, which will force his opponent to either have the Blade Flurry and trade some of his minions in. But even then, if his opponent had Blade Flurry, he'd almost be dead. So I think Shaki feels like he can't afford to play around Blade Flurry.
Yeah, he needs to play. He doesn't have anything else to play. He has to play it, but he's going to be dead. I don't think there's any way for him to survive here. Because he can't clear both of those. There's the deckhand with an oil.
Yep, even the 1/1 surviving. I mean, you don't really necessarily need the deckhand, just 2 more damage.
Or is he dead yet? How much is that?
6.
So it could be 8 from the weapon and 6. Okay, 14. So he's not quite dead just yet.
Yeah, he's got 14 damage.
But I mean, how does he climb back from this?
Yeah, what does he do about that weapon? He basically needs to top deck Harrison Jones and then pick up like a heal bot off the top.
Yeah, what's really funny too. Well, okay, I was gonna say, Sap The funny thing about Sap was that it gives your opponent a chance to heal if by some weird reason he has it. But in this case, it doesn't really matter because it is board presence. Man, that Assassin's Blade though, going to work. Harrison Jones?
Oh, nope. That's not it. So Harrison Jones into Healbot would have been like one turn delay. A few turns, actually. You might have been able to win if he'd gotten exactly those two cards. But didn't pick them up. Priest looking to be a liability for both teams at the moment. Then again, I think the pick from Archon was very well forethought. I mean, that the assumption that the opponent would go in with Priest is was a good one.
Yeah, such a great pick there. That's how you would expect Rogue Priest game to go as well. Like there wasn't really anything Chucky could have done better from my in my opinion. And it's just kind of bad luck or maybe bad pick. Like who knows?
You can definitely say that there's an element of luck to it because there was choice in its blind pick, so you don't really, you can't ever truly tell. But if I were to guess, I would say that Archon may have anticipated that Force and Boys may have tried to play on the fear of getting benched. Because a lot of teams have also been sending like one guy and then game number two is a different guy and game number three is a different guy, so they can avoid ever getting benched early on, even though it has the least impact. So perhaps they went into a level of mind games. Perhaps they just flipped a coin and 6-0 ended up just queuing again. Or maybe 6-0 tilted and said, I want to play again and refused to let other guys play. There could be so many stories here. But the one that I like the most is the mind games one.
Yeah, I think it was mind games. They didn't expect the rogue there and that's why they queued up the priest. I think the priest might become like the big story of this.
Priest versus priest in game 11.
Even before the match even started, we're like, oh, priest is pretty weak. Like, I don't know about the priest. And now we've seen two games, and both of those have been lost by a priest.
Yeah.
Yeah, it's like
pretty bad sign.
Every single, as I said like earlier, it's the same thing every single time with six classes in the current meta. You've got five obvious go to, and then four that you don't know what to do with, and whoever gets stuck with that, hey, I don't know what to do with class, tends to have a worse score than the other ones, just because the class is so volatile. It's kind of interesting.
Yeah, that's interesting too. And I think that this priest does have some room for good matchups. It's not like it can be bad against everything. And unfortunately for Tobaganda, who says, "I hope Shocking can go undefeated." It's not the case anymore, but he still could be a really valuable player because in the end, no matter which team you ask, there is going to be one player stuck with a lineup that maybe they're not as comfortable with as they'd like to be, right? They can't play the five other classes that people have generally accepted to be pretty good. You have to pick one that might be liable if it's Druid, if it's Priest, Paladin, or Shamans.
Yep. Well, it's I am surprised we don't see Shaman. I think Shaman would have been an okay pick. I think it ultimately comes down to, of all the other four classes, which of those beat the... It's like they have their own metagame. Like, which of these four classes is better than the other three? Like, relatively in power. So it's like, what are you going to bring? Very often, Druid seems like the obvious go-to. We saw Gaara bring it yesterday. He brought Shaman, got, you know, two losses off of it. And at the same time, Life Coach brought Druid and also hit a roadblock with two losses. So it still turned out to be kind of even. So it depends on whether or not the Priest is going to go, like, 1-2 or just 0-5.
What's really funny about something like tournament statistics. I know Monk was quoting it yesterday, and he did a very good job going through all VODs and marking them down manually to track tournament statistics for win percentages. But the thing about that is some classes overperform because the people who are brave enough to bring it are also well experienced and might even line it up correctly to predict some aspects of the metagame. So okay. I think Priest in tournament play doesn't even have the worst win rate. It's like actually one of the better ones. But that's because guys who specialize in Priest would end up bringing it, like GCT Turf, for example. He plays
Kalento, man. Just
or
Kalento,
right? Kalento is one of them, too. And it's like, wow, actually, Priest has like a 60% win rate. That doesn't sound right.
Yeah. You're right. Well, pretty cool Zeus start. Pretty decent start here for Firebat.
No turn 2, though. That's actually a big deal. He needs to top deck something for turn 2.
What do you mean, life taps not a turn 2?
It doesn't really do that.
No, I know that. I know.
Well, was there any merit to holding on to the Voidwalker so you can coin out Imp Gang Boss and then get another couple of draws for the Voidwalker to fill out the curve with whatever you draw.
Actually, you're right.
I would have went for that, I think. Because of the lack of 2-drop, I would have went just Flame Imp there. I don't think the Voidwalker does that much. So you'd have pushed out the Imp Gang boss on turn 2 in case you missed the 2-drop.
Yeah, what does it really stop at 2
maybe,
mana?
The thing is, if you go for the... Like, sure, you're not stopping a backstab either way on the Flame Imp, but what you're stopping is the possibility for the Rogue to go for Deadly Poison on turn 3 and kill your Flame Imp, and you're left with nothing but an Imp Gang boss. That's, like, the only thing I could think of, and then the Voidwalker dies on the following turn to the Deadly Poison, so he gets, like, 2 kills with it instead of nothing for the next few ones. That's kind of a minor thing. It's not a big deal. But
even then, Imp Gang boss is really problematic for many classes to deal with. Rogue especially being one of them, with all those 1 damage, 2 damage pairs. Imp Gang boss is not a clean removal. I like this play too. Oskaka setting up for Fan of Knives to potentially be very effective. Even though traditional logic shows you should backstab that Flame Imp, reduce the amount of damage. Ends up paying off in the sense that he can now get an easy board removal and cycle through now.
Yeah, that's true. Wow, an empty board. That's a.
when does that happen?
Yeah.
It's like,
yeah.
Is it really Zoo? Am I facing off against some weird variant of Warlock that I'd never seen before? he does pick up another Flame Imp, though.
Yeah, and I was about to ask, I wonder if maybe Firebat went for that play because he was playing a slightly lower curve Zoo that doesn't go really high, but we see him have Mal'Ganis in hand, so we at least have Void Callers and other ways to be a little bit more board-centric Zoo that people approach as mid-range. So, you know, he was really banking on drawing the 2 mana cost there, or at least 1 mana cost. Yeah.
So this is a bit of a weird spot for Skaka because he's got to get the sprint out, and using prep on sprint isn't necessarily bad. The problem is that suddenly the tempo plays that you usually want to get with that prep against a Zoo player are out of the window for a bit until you pick up the second one.
That's true. Like I personally used to do that a lot, prepping the sprint almost any time that I could on turn 4. But in matchups like this, it's so good for the tempo to use maybe on an oil. But the situation was that if he didn't go for that play, he didn't really have anything else to do. So it was the only play. You don't want to zap a 3-drop.
Oh yeah. My god. I am seeing an amazing Blade Flurry next turn with the Blood Mage. That pickup from Sprint is actually really solid.
Yeah, that's a good point. There's a 4 damage wipe on the board. Assuming it goes that way, there also is Defender of Argus possibilities, or even things that might annoy you, like a couple of Haunted Creepers or Nerubian Egg that makes you attack into them first.
How would you rate the... Like, Savich, I'm going to ask this question to you. What's the win rate of Oil Rogue versus this type of Zoo deck very often?
I think Oil Rogue does quite well.
Okay.
I feel like it's pretty good, but it depends on the draws too. Like, if there's no backstep, the early damage might be too much.
But yeah, and huge Void Terror, no sap. That
Lotheb.
Yeah, Lotheb to shut down almost all your plays the following turn.
Yeah, the Lotheb helps so much. I added it a while ago. It used to be more popular to launch Sylvanas instead of it. The Lotheb is just so much better in many matchups. And here again, it's like the Lotheb is winning the game. Otherwise, the Blade Flurry would have been a blowout.
Yeah, he's got the heal bot, basically. Like, nothing but heal bot is really going to get him out of this. But then that means your weapon is not going to be developed for the following turn.
Such a weak turn. Just playing a 3-3.
Yeah.
Like
for 5 mana.
Obviously. But it's so bad. Like, the board is not getting any better. Looking at another 11 damage just on the board, even if he clears an Imp Gang boss. No, he probably clears the Flame Imp to reduce the damage.
Yeah, then there's only 9 on board that way.
Yeah, makes him such a powerhouse.
Sure. Yeah, taking the damage off the board.
You know, I think Lotheb is the type of tech card that I find very healthy, that I wish we had more of in the game. I wonder if it was implemented to deal with Miracle Rogue and then it turned out to become something else entirely, still being a thorn in Rogue's side.
That could be what happens. It's really funny how card rules end up changing depending on how you anticipate it. It's still really amusing to me that Grim Patron's a neutral card, for example. It's like, well, I'm pretty sure only one class can reasonably play. He's like, oh no, you can ping it in mage.
Yeah, you can injured Blademaster Rampage, man. Didn't you know that? You can play Rampage so on it.
Yeah. And you're playing Master.
I tried it, man. I tried it with Crush, believe it or not. I was like, hey, it self-damages. That's going to work. Nope. 6 mana for Beast of Removal with a 4-3 is not worth it.
Well, you have a lot of cards, but do you have the plays here to stabilize? Is there one that allows him to clear the board?
Like, this is where he would have needed the prep so badly.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, Dagger, Deadly, Blood Mage, like, it kind of gets the job half done. But at this point, since you're spawning additional imps, like, is it even worth it? Sap play? No, sap on what? What could you sap? I mean, I was going to say Drake, sap, Earthling, Farseer, SI.
All the options seem really bad.
Now, Earthling, Farseer, SI.
You can't even, like, biggest minion on board is the Lothar, but you don't, yeah. You can't sap that. Just lose the game.
What do you mean you can't sap Lothar?
Oh, you can! Yeah. My bad.
Why not, man? You only live once. That's not too bad. At least he's gonna take away a lot of damage by sapping the egg before he goes for the board clear.
Yeah, I really like this play. I think it was very good.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, Skaka are playing really well here.
It's still almost unwinnable, if not unwinnable. Taking so much, and there's the power overwhelming, and I can never be an X pack.
Yeah,
so.
I was gonna say, just PO that poor imp and send him to hell.
Yeah, I mean, I would like to see the Void Terror here. Just PO the imp and play the Nerubian X to it. And I guess gonna be a sap, but still, like getting 10 to face this turn. Then it leaves the Rogue dead to a Doomguard top deck.
Yeah, I think the fact that it gives you the out on a top deck is worth it. And the odds of the Rogue really coming back here with, you know, counter damage is very slim.
Yeah.
Wow, that's so devastating.
Okay, so if he picks up an Eviscerate, I think he can get a full clear, because he can start by sapping the big minion, Eviscerate the 4 for an
He's got no sap. That's the thing, he just used it on the egg.
That's right, there's no
sap is gone.
That's the Evis, but there's no sap.
BGH wouldn't even solve it.
That's
rest in peace, I think he's Skaga. Dead. There's really nothing else he could do.
I'm so happy to see Void Terror swing back in the metagame. It used to be kind of a funky tech in Zoo, but now it feels like it's more effective than ever, despite the fact that the Death Rattle metagame is gone. Like, you don't have the old school, you know, Naxx from a Zoo, but somehow the Void Terror is better than it's ever been.
Yeah, I think it's just because there's so many Death Rattle sticky minions that it just got even more resilient. Before, Void Terror was seen a little bit of a jokey card that you use to try to, like, cheese someone out. But, I mean, that was because the best Death Rattle mana were, like, Harvest Golem. It's like, people used to play that card. And now you have so many ways to synergize it with all those extra imps off Implosion or Imp Gang Boss or their eggs and the Haunted Creepers. There's just so much synergy with that. And some people even, you know, they play slow like Sylvanas. They play Sylvanas and Void Terror Sylvanas, and that's when I rage quit and destroy my keyboard.
Especially when they steal exactly what they need to steal.
Yeah.
That's when it gets really aggravating.
I don't need my keyboard anyways. I play Hearthstone, so it's fine.
Yeah, I have a mouse. I'm good to go. I have like 17 mice on the side.
Gosh.
If I play against too many patron warriors.
Which might be coming up eventually. We have two warriors that are yet to come up. Oskaka has one. Zalay has one. Zalay has yet to make his appearance of the day. We have seen all of the Forsen boys so far. We start off with Forsen grabbing a win. Chalky dropping with Priest. And then Oskaka dropping with Rogue. Forsen boys off to not the best start, but I think there's still, you know, lots of room for comeback. The big question is, you know, when will these power classes like Hunter and Warrior be mixed in? And then how will it relate to classes like Priest, which seem to struggle currently?
Yeah. You know, I'm curious to know if Oskaka would have brought Control Warrior, because I know Zalay is a very experienced Warrior player either way for the archetypes, but he seems to favor the Grim Patron a lot more ever since it's come up. Whereas I think Control Warrior is still very strong no matter what, especially if you expect Firebat to bring, say, Freeze Mage. That's another good matchup you can always get. Patron's good, but Control Warrior is even better. It can do pretty well against Hunter, assuming you're not running against a pure midrange. So I think Control Warrior wouldn't be too bad for Oskaka if he plays it here. Well, either player, really, considering the lineups.
Yeah, it would not be bad, but I would still expect to see two patrons, at least from Zalae, like almost 100%, and from Ostgog too. I haven't seen him play either Warrior, but based on Ostgog's style, because he likes a lot of combo decks, he plays Freeze Mage a lot, and in general, just combo decks. So the patron would be so well in line with those.
Yeah, it makes sense. And I mean, it's one of those things where initially I thought Patron was more like Freeze Mage, and then as time passed, it became more and more like Miracle Rogue. Like, the deck switched playstyles from a more passive one to a very aggressive dig through your deck playstyle, which I thought was kind of peculiar, really. I mean, it's one of those changes in the way the deck was played and refined that I didn't expect. And, you know, a lot of people bring up the fact that it's so hard to interact with it, like Miracle Rogue is. But I think it's almost solely enabled by Emperor Thorsen. Like, if you cut that card out, that deck suddenly loses a lot of its power.
Well, that is sometimes it really needs it more than anything. In the meantime, we see Forsen Boys rotating Chalky back in with the Priest. Firebat gonna stick around on the Mage and seeing he can close it out. And if it's Freeze Mage, this Priest once again hits quite the wall it must overcome.
It's so grim if it's Freeze Mage. If it's a Tempo Mage, Tempo Mage has been getting more popular, and Firebat is a player who can mix it up and is capable of playing anything, then the Priest is going to have a good time. But he's kind of famous still for their Freeze Mage, so anything else but that would be a surprise.
Yeah, it's what he won his back-to-back Gfinities with, the Freeze Mage combinations. Firebat even posted a spreadsheet very famously that explains Conquest's best win percentages, and it was it was a really cool tool that he shared with the community. Kind of like a secret look into his success. And Freeze Mage was like the deck that he loved one of the most. Now, at the same time, I think you guys shouldn't underestimate the power of something like Valence Chosen, and he ends up drawing it. So if this Deathlord gets Valence Chosen on it, Freeze Mage has to get a lot of damage onto it, or Doomsayer has to be super effective against it.
Doomsayer is can it's be quite love, actually. I think it's quite easy. Doomsayer is the key card against Priest, because there's almost no way to deal with it unless there's some Shadowward Pains mixed in. And I'm like thinking that the Shadowward Pain might be a good meta call right now if you want to play it.
I really like it.
At least one.
Yeah, it's good against Acolytes of Pain against, if you're playing against, say, a Patron deck and whatnot, you're going to generally get value out of it against everything.
Yeah.
It's kind of like playing Stampede and Kodo and Pally as a one-off. You're like, oh, this is effective, and Priest can use it even better because they play Wild Pyromancers against some of the more aggressive decks. Like, it still is with Creepers, Mad Scientists, and Knife Jugglers, so.
It's a good point. You know, you can not only kill the Doomsayer, you can kill Imp Gang bosses without triggering their
Whoa! There it is!
What a time to draw it!
Chalky even made a little small face. Wow. Like, alright, well, don't mind if I do.
That is sick. Alright, well, that's the card he wanted to see most in the world, no doubt.
First, Chalky is with us on this Shadowward Pain thing.
Now, you just have to not misclick, because you still can kill your own minion by accident. Okay.
And but it doesn't matter, because you summon Antonitis, and then it dies to the Doomsayer, and then you win.
Yeah.
That'll be next level.
Yeah, that would have been so crazy, though. That's the kind of play you want to see in a tournament setting once, after the guy's calculated all the minions. He's like, wait, there's only one card left in that deck, and it's the Alex. Well, goodbye.
I know this is not the case at all, but I'd really love the next card was Inner Fire. Just to smack him for 12. That'd be so...
That'd be hilarious.
I wouldn't be surprised as a one-of. It's almost good. It's almost good enough. You can use it on Doomsayers with Shadowward Death if you have to.
That's the equivalent of a Draxus that got buffed by a Defender of Argus.
Sounds balanced.
That'd be such a cool card if you knew what you were up against. Like, if you knew that in some... Because the tournament rules keep changing a little bit, depending on the tournament. And if you had a tournament where the rules kind of let you know that you would... It's likely that you are going to be playing as Freeze Mage and stuff. Maybe you could mix it in.
It is one of those matchups slow enough where you could benefit off of it.
Yeah, exactly.
Yeah. Interesting.
How much burn is there? Actually, the thing is, it almost doesn't matter how much health Shocky stacks up if that Alex falls down before he's gotten any damage in. But I think Firebat's a little bit under pressure. There's really no way for him to do anything. After that failed Doomsayer, this Deathlord is stacking up the damage.
the only way to remove that last Death Lord is the Doomsayer. He's not gonna Pyroblast and Fireball it. Like, he's the last Doomsayer.
It also gets healed by Circle of Healing, so if you try to, like, two-turn remove it, it'll just continue to get blasted. So you're just stuck with a four-attack minion that's gonna be on your opponent's board until you get Doomsayer.
Maybe with Emperor he can go, like, double Fireball, Frostbolt being on it.
Yeah, sure, let's do that.
That
12 mana loot hoarder.
But that's such a immovable object right now. It's pretty crazy.
So how important is it to keep Zombie Chow so you can use it for a blast with the Akhenai Soul Priest if you can draw it? Do you value it more as a minion on board at all, or do you think saving it for that is might be even better?
Like as a mind blast?
Yeah, I don't think there's any point in playing it, really. It's likely that it's going to die before it deals 5 damage because of the flame strikes. But what he could do is draw 4 cards here if he wishes.
Oh, yeah, yes.
The Wildfire really allows that. It's
I
must consider. Is it worth doing all that?
I'm not sure.
Actually, you have to heal your opponent with Light of the Naru because it won't summon a Light Warden unless you're still damaged. He's at 2 much. Sure.
Yeah, that's true. Oh, he could have drawn. We thought play 5. Just dropping the Zombie Chow here. Okay. Expecting to deal more damage than 5 with.
Sure.
Or wants it for trading with a scientist. Makes sense in that. Because the mage might drop a scientist and then you can keep going face with that Deathlord.
How confident is a mage dropping a mad scientist right now, though? Starting to creep onto a Cabal Shadow Priest range?
That's true.
This is also pretty clever from Jockey. He wants his opponent to ping the face again so he can Light of the Naru his own face. This is something that a lot of priests and warrior players autopilot, and they're not really considering how much health they're at.
Yeah, Battle Rage as well. Yeah. It's like works the same way, basically.
Yeah, exactly. It's like, oh, I have 34 health as a warrior, and I can't Battle Rage in this perfect scenario to draw 4 cards, type of thing.
That would be amazing amazing read if he didn't ping face here, but how can you make a call like that? You don't expect the Light of the Naru in this situation.
Yep, exactly. So this is a really advanced play from Chalky. Fireback could have made an equally advanced play, but those are just reserved for the Cryptcast sometimes, We can get those obscure references out. Well, he's going to draw 5 cards now? 4 cards?
Is he gonna? He's got to go 5. For it, right? He's got to go to. Like, yeah, it's too
much. Actually, 6. He can draw 6 because he can use the hero power afterwards.
Oh, you're right. Sounds good to me. And by the way, that Light Warden will be really scary. He's going to have to ping that. He's going to have to ping something, but he's going to heal it back up.
Oh,
wow.
Okay, okay. Guys, let's not get too crazy here.
are you sure about that?
Is he overdraw? He circles again?
Injured circle? I mean, even if you overdraw, is that a problem?
Yeah, that could be a good point.
Well, then again, you also want to heal out the Light Warden, so it forces a piece of removal by your opponent.
I would go for it. I mean, he has plenty of cards left in his deck. It's so much stuff on the board.
No, you have to heal that that poor thing.
Well, you can still heal it after you serve.
And he does draw a card. Just doesn't add the Blade Master now.
Mm-hmm.
That's not even... It's quite good with the 13 and 2.
Oh, wow.
Yeah,
that's exactly what he wanted.
even if he didn't though, he still had Frost Nova to stall, so it wasn't the worst case scenario there.
No. We get excited when stuff like that happens.
No, it was pretty sick. I mean, Chalky got the Shadow Word Pain right off the top too.
Yep, goes both ways.
Okay, so Cabal Shadow Priest also has a little value. Not compared to other classes like Zoo, where you can steal Imp Gang Boss, for example, but you can take their acolytes at the acolyte ping, and that really denies their ability to draw too. So I wouldn't necessarily rush putting out there, because you can still put another 4 or 5 out effectively with the injured Blade Master.
Yeah, they can heal even better than the Cabal.
It's got more potential.
Yep, and it's also going to cost you a bit less, 1 mana less. Not that you're going to spend it anyway, but what's interesting is I wonder how likely it is that Chalky can actually out-heal this Alexstrasza.
With this hand, it's not happening.
Yeah. Oh, wow.
What a card to draw. Oh my goodness.
Sick card to find here.
Totally.
14. Yeah.
You don't seem as enthusiastic about it than we are.
Oh, I'm trying to count to see if Chalky can pop the ice block this turn, but I don't think...
Double Nova?
No, he's at 15 damage.
And only 9 mana, yeah.
So he has the Valence chosen, so I believe he has 17.
Oh, you're right.
But still not quite enough.
And two Holy Novas would kill Alexstrasza.
I wonder.
Yeah.
Next
turn, maybe.
Yeah.
Because he can't yet.
It would already kill it because of Wild Pyro. It would be like 4 each on it.
That's crazy. If Priest was able to do just 2 more damage anytime during the game.
I kind of like that, actually. And or isn't any good. I guess you have to load up here.
Yeah, you have to circle to trade away some of your... Oh, wow. Yeah. He's gonna stay out of range of lethal and then maybe follow up with an even more like high pressure Lotheb. Because if Firebat goes for, say, a really high pressure play here, to go face with Burn, playing the second Lotheb, as playing the Lotheb on the back of it is going to prevent the second wave of it.
Yeah, I really like that play. That was a good one. Didn't even need to like necessarily clear that, but they are. Wow. Antoninus.
Yeah.
Yeah, Antoninus gives him more burn, and you know, Chalky couldn't go for double Holy Nova. He might be able to Holy Nova again this turn, but still the problem exists where if his opponent has too much damage, he doesn't have enough heal to combat it. But that's where the Lotheb really comes in, because you might have the damage to kill him, but you don't have the mana available. And then it comes down to whether or not Firebat has like a second ice block, for example, right? Or a way to kill from the hand once the ice block is popped.
So, does he go for a Nova play, or does he use Frostbolt Ice Lance?
I think if you anticipate your ice block being popped, you need to keep that Frost Nova, unless you really want to try and see if you can stall for damage here. I don't really think there's 5 damage burst that's existing. Like, he already used a Zombie Chow, right?
Holy Fire, I guess.
We haven't seen any Holy Fires in a long time.
That's true. That Deathlord's a champion.
Yeah, it was the carry of this entire game.
Well, this is painful. He doesn't have that Shadow Ward Death.
Yeah, but with Lotheb, it's as good as a Shadow Ward Death. Well, then again, you're right. Like, because he still has to pop the block and then stay alive one more turn. So it's a bit tricky.
He's gonna get like one extra fireball, I guess.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. One mana from being able to kill the Antoninus. Now, I guess his best chance really is the Lotheb. Otherwise, this Antoninus would just collect way too much value just for one turn, right?
He has to do the Lotheb, but it doesn't feel good because he can pop on the same turn.
And then he heals him. Doesn't he feel obligated to heal himself too? Because he knows his opponent's been generating damage.
I mean, I guess you could just push for full damage. Because at the moment, you know you're not going to get Flamestrike. You know you're not going to get Blizzarded. So the only thing that's going to stop you is another Nova for 8 mana. It's like
second ice block. That's almost going to be the nail in the coffin here.
Yeah.
Because now there's, let's see, 12.
You can 15, kill 13. You can go Fireball, Frostbolt, Ice Lance, and play the second block. That is just
next
disgusting.
Turn. He's got exactly what he needs. The thing is, if there's a Kazan Mystic here, that could have gotten sick, but...
There better be. I think that's the only way at this point.
Yeah, there's not. Or the
I can see the appeal of a Holy Nova, although the thing about the Holy Nova, too, is that... he has Arcanine Soul Priest, that's fine. I was going to say, like, he has to make sure to have damage from the hand. So that way he can kill in case his board gets frozen by a Blizzard or another Frost Nova or something. So Ice Block, and then you do 13 damage and you have Pyroblast the next turn.
Yeah.
Seems and you will have 6, so Chalky is forced to have the Light of the Naru. That's his last out here to survive.
Is that even enough?
Is it enough?
With Ice Lance? Yeah, it's going to be marginally enough.
It would be enough, yeah.
The Light of the Naru is his only draw. No.
Oh, that's not it.
Can he do anything with Light Bombing? No.
Kill his own
Deathlord.
Deathlord and then steal... No.
Spawn a Zombie Chow, then kill a Zombie Chow, and then...
Where is that Kazan Mystic when you need it?
Yeah. I don't think it was in their deck. I thought it was in
It was in the other deck. I believe it was in the Archon's Priest.
Yeah, that's right. Well, that's kind of amusing the way that works.
So Archon put Kazan Mystic and Force and Boys put in Shadow Word Pain. To each their tech, basically. We don't know if maybe Archon also plays Shadow Word Pain. It might just have it.
Wow.
I remember the days of 8 mana Pyroblast. Those were the days.
It was not even the fact that Pyroblast was 8 mana and the damage cost to them. It was just the fact that you could turn 8 Pyro, turn 9 Pyro. It's like, well, that's just... Mm-hmm. It's like, well, you did like 5 damage to me and now I have to worry about dying in the next couple of turns. That type of stuff, so... Yeah.
Well, that was a pretty good match either way. I think that Deathlord really was what could have made the difference. Like, that second Ice Block pickup by Firebat was the most crucial thing that could have happened, I think.
Yeah.
Yeah, it was a big deal. And it's surprisingly close. I wouldn't have expected it to be that close, considering that we didn't see a heal pot or Kazan.
Mm-hmm.
And, right.
Yeah, it's two bad matchups for Priest. You can see that there's definitely an intended goal that Priest comes in this week, or today specifically, to try and target something, but it's just not lining up for Force and Boys. Firebat's done for the day, so he's got... He can just relax, kick back, and see what Sixo and Zalea are up to. But it's still not looking good right now for Force and Boys. They're going to need to turn around quick.
Yeah. How's Firebat been doing overall? I think he only lost once in the second week, right? With his Warlock deck. Like, he's been very consistent with his win rate so far in the league.
He certainly has. Firebat's one of the most respected players in the world. He wanted to represent the North American region for NA versus China. Don't think he got his visa issues figured out, but if there was a representative from America, I would pick him along with Strifecrow to be like two of the top players from the entire region.
I think a lot of people would agree.
I think he's the ace and the captain of the team as well, which makes sense. Even though I believe he's also the youngest. Zalea is kind of like a grandpa. He's like 26, I
think. And the esports scene is like...
Right, and Firebat's like 19. Okay. He just turned 19 recently, I believe. It's kind of hard to imagine he's just so young.
I think going to med school and then Hearthstone came up. Right? Or is that someone else that I'm confused? Because I know Dog wasn't there.
That's Dog. Yeah. Firebat was working... at a car shop, I believe.
Wasn't he going to become a doctor or something? And he mentioned something about... I might have just fabricated a memory, but I recall him saying that at some point in the past. But, you know, fabricating memories.
I'd believe it. I think he's a really bright kid, despite being a working adult from the age of 17 onwards.
It's happening! Priest is going to get a win!
Oh yeah! Who's Kazan Mystic is going to be the best?
Well, I don't know if there's Kazan Mystic in Chalky's.
Yeah. I'd like to see it, but it's unlikely. We haven't seen it in 2 games. So, well, then again, it didn't dig through the entire deck, right? We saw, like, at most 20 cards in one matchup. But it could still be in there, hiding.
All right. Well, there's the Ooze from Chalky. Oh, no, from Sixo. He's got Ooze and Kazan. What? All right.
Wow. So it's like Anti-Hunter,
I think he just has to throw in like Blood Knight and he'd have the Holy Trinity of 8 cards. why not a Hemet, Ness, and Wary? I think why stop there? Just go all out. Black
Tink
Knight.
Master Hemet combo, man. You've got to do it. You have to do it. It's a great combo. It negates anything in the game. It happened to me recently.
Plus the Ooze. Yeah.
You got it, man. You got 4 cards that work well together. Amazing.
Now this is really hilarious. It's like, well, yeah, every time you draw a card, I draw a card, and vice versa. And then there's a such thing as having too many cards sometimes in the Priest mirror, where you just start keeping your opponent's Northshire on the board, and you keep healing it, so that way they can draw more cards and fatigue faster.
Games turn like that at some point, where you just mill it, because these take a while.
Yeah, but I like this position here for Frick Sixo, because the Deathlord allows him to get a really good Valen's Chosen play that's going to kill the Northshire in one turn eventually, assuming it doesn't get buffed up any further, which, as we know.
And he also knows that Chalky plays Shadow Word Pain, which could be a disaster. If he Shadow Word Pains this, and then, you know, like his opponent has Circle of Healing, he attacks his opponent Northshire Clearer, draws 3 cards, and like has a 4/7. Although his opponent would also draw 3 cards too, so it wouldn't be the worst.
Yeah, the fact that it's symmetrical really evens out the the advantage that you would usually generate. Against another matchup, this would be devastating, but in this one, it's a little less of a problem. Oh, wow.
Part of the Shredder. That's interesting.
Shredder and Priest. All right, so that's pretty cool.
Well, that was what originally you used to put in, right?
Yeah, mm-hmm. I think at some point it was a common thing, but it also a bit faded out and hasn't been seen in a while.
Priest hasn't been seen in a while.
Priest, that's also true, yeah.
Yeah.
But in the recent list, like the one that Doc played, and it had Sentient Shieldmasters in it.
And that is old school. Oh, that's a good pickup. Well, then again, since it draws your opponent a card, at least you're like one Light Warden ahead, right?
Yeah, but it is as much as a resource battle as it is like a board battle too. Like, if you have significant amount of cards compared to your opponent, and you're dumping your cards like Light Warden into nothing, then you're gonna be fighting at disadvantage because he gets to pick off a good trade. Like in this scenario, it's a pretty easy kill on the Light Warden.
Yeah. Wow, so many card draws.
This is becoming quite the clown fiesta.
Didn't say that.
Well, now you want to kill a Northshire Cleric, but then you have to leave up his Light Wardens. And if you heal your Death Lord preemptively, you also give him a card draw.
Yeah, it's like Conundrum. This is a perfect example.
It's like, do I want to help my opponent hurt me type thing?
And you can't heal your Death Lord and attack into the Light Warden because then you die. It dies as well.
Oh yeah, no matter what, the Light Warden matches the damage and healing of the Death Lord.
I think the Clown Fiesta thing is pretty accurate on this one.
Oh no!
Oh wow, the counter Death Lord. Oh, this Light Warden is going to be so good. This Light Warden is going to be so sick.
Oh man, Holy Nova, right? Would be like crazy damage.
Well, I mean, at some point you're going to have to... be afraid, because it's gonna die to Nova or Shadow Ward Death eventually. But if you can get a Shadow Ward Death used up on the Light Warden,
that's even
God! I don't even know.
Wait. Okay, so at this point, 6-0 wants Chalky to kill his Northshire Cleric, right? I must consider. Because like, why would you attack into that unless you're trying to anticipate that your Northshire Cleric would die?
Well, if they heal, then you're... I don't really know, honestly. Like, what's the point of it?
Yeah. The Valence Chosen should come out. I've played enough this matchup. Like, the Valence Chosen needs to happen on that Death Lord.
Yeah.
Other stuff, like, do you trade or not, or what do you do? I have no idea. But getting that 4-11, like, that wins so many games.
Yep. And it's so far away from being able to be destroyed or stolen by the Cabal Shadow Priest and Shrinkmeister. Does he have to like hold over just this little Light Warden?
Oh man.
You get a Shadow Ward Death it, I guess, but
it also feels bad.
Yeah, it feels terrible.
Well, that's interesting too, considering that Shadow Ward Death, how many targets realistically are in it outside of like Sylvanas?
Ragnaros maybe. Oh wow. That's not too bad, giving him a little bit more damage out of the Nova.
Yep.
Well, you can steal this now.
Yeah, thank you.
Wow, that's convenient. I got my own Nova to buff up. Thanks.
Is this a point where he
needs to have Light Bomb? Yeah.
Yeah. Or like he's worried about overextending onto the board, but I don't think so. I think it's still really powerful here just to take it. You expect that your opponent will also be stealing it back, but that gives you the extra edge because now you get to dictate the terms of the trades because you have the better board.
Yep.
It's like the old like mind control battles. Back in the day, priests used to have cheap mind controls for 8 mana. So it'd be like whoever mind controls first, if they have a minion on board, they're like super far ahead because then the second person feels like they have the mind control, but then they use up their entire mana curve.
Yeah, and they end up taking like, you know, 8 damage in the process, and then sometimes it gets Shadow Ward Death and then nothing gets done.
That circle pickup is amazing. Like that Death Lord was getting a little bit low, but never mind. Like he can heal it back up now.
4-9? 4-8? Well, he's gonna, looks like, use Holy Nova, right?
Mm-hmm.
Oh, wait. No, he can just use Circle of Killing and...
The Injured, maybe. But then again, you're really... That's the point where I think you're going overextending on the Light Bomb front, because by weakening all your minions by, like, 1 health, the Cabal suddenly dies to the...
So it's fine, though, because now your Death Lord's back to a 4... Well, I thought it was 4-10, but it's 4-9.
Those other minions don't matter as much. Mm-hmm. They can just die.
Yeah, it's
well,
pretty much perfect.
Wow.
That's just a bad draw.
And that Ysera is doing absolutely nothing.
It's well, so slow. If it's
given time, it has time. It has ability to dominate, but time is not on 6-0's side. This matchup was surprisingly quick. You know, it's one of the things where we said that it could take a while, but it really isn't the case here.
Yeah, it's like I feel like the one who gets Valence chosen often has a huge advantage. Here both had one, but then Chucky picked up a second one. And it's just like, now that the Deathlord has taken over.
It's I was gonna say it's not quite over yet, but never mind that. That's gonna be another massive card here for Chucky.
4 damage.
But then the cleric is gonna draw for it.
It's gonna draw a lot of cards, yeah.
Oh, you're right.
He's going to draw the cards, so he might pick up a light bomb from that. It's like a weird interaction. Even if it dies, it still draws.
Yeah, that's a good point.
What if you don't Nova? Is there a possibility you just trade your stuff away into that Deathlord to get an extra minion? Like, you really don't have to go for it necessarily.
But you also do want to heal. It's like part of
yeah.
It. Nice little spot there, realizing the spell power buff, plus the wild pyromancer is overkill.
Oh, zombie chow. Okay.
Where's light bomb?
Zombie chow. Okay. Where's the light bomb?
Yeah, no, it wouldn't do much anything. It wouldn't do anything here anyway.
He would have to light bomb with spell power in order to have a chance.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, it's not happening.
Nope.
Senjin, Valence Chosen opens you up to Shadow or Death,
maybe
so that's not an option.
Oh, wait, never mind. I don't know why I was suggesting that. I was like, maybe you can Shadow Madness and Valence Chosen something. I was like, no, that's stupid.
Let's buff it up and give it back.
I don't know. It's like, you have to think of weird plays sometimes, Priest.
It's the only play he had, but it's not good enough.
Yeah, Shadow or Death should be able to push through it, and that is a Priest win for the Forsen boys. It took
doesn't
3 tries.
He's gonna go for the zombie chow lethal. Fastest action per second.
I like it. I like it.
Nice.
Quick and concise. That was much quicker than
anticipated.
Than most mirrors.
Yeah. It was pretty quick.
Yeah.
I mean, Priest versus Priest used to be one of those things where people could justifiably spam Resident Sleeper, but I think that even the Priest decks have had to adapt to where, you know, I think the Valence Chosen version, you call it, was it Chinese Priest?
Well, you call it a light bomb priest, but I don't know if Death Lords even warrant light bombs anymore. It's just kind of weird. It's just priest now.
Okay.
Yeah, at some point, it was called like the first viable version of light bomb priest. It was a Chinese one, so that's where the name came from.
Yeah, it had Gilbert Stalker initially, if I recall. So it changed to abuse Valence Chosen, and then they realized they really didn't need it. But it is, I think the deck is by default a bit faster than its pure control counterpart that we used to run a long time ago as like the standard priest list that Amaz, I almost want to say popularized, because I think he was like the first massive name to play it on stream. So it's like that version of priest never really lived and aged well, whereas the Chinese one has picked up a lot of steam.
All right, well, that was the second win for Forsen boys, a much-needed one, considering that Priest was on the verge of losing its third in a row and would have had to be... I think that would have been benched for Chalky, too, which meant Oskako of Forsen had to come out. And also, 6-0 being able to win with the Priest would have been devastating, because that means Zalae just has to win with Warrior and Hunter, and from there, it feels like it's smooth sailing. That was also a matchup where I think 6-0 had one of the best chances to win, even though he had a lot of tech cards that don't help the matchup. It's like, you know, Priest versus Priest, you always can run away with the game based off cards like Valence Chosen, like you said. So now that the other Priest is out of the way, there's not many classes remaining that the Priest is like good against. You know?
This is discouraging, man. It's like the best matchup for Priest is a 50-50, and then everything else is worse. That's
6-0 needs to match it up against Jockey's Hunter.
Yeah,
if Jack's Hunter gets a win from something else, that priest just can't win. Well, it can. Like, with the right draws, anything is possible. It's going to have such a hard time against Rogue and a Handlock and, what was the zoo?
Patron, I guess. There's Patron left.
Yeah, and Patrons.
Well.
Yes. Yeah.
I mean, Light Bomb's good against them, but really, that's it's a one-trick pony, then you get killed in one turn by a Frothing Berserker and you're out.
Yep. Like, the amount of time that Patrons has against the Priest is ridiculous.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, it's like, I can draw my entire deck and fatigue a little bit before I actually have to go all in.
Yep.
Hunter, yeah, Hunter versus Rogue. This is the first time we'll be seeing Zalay all day. He comes in game number 6. And Hunter against Rogue has traditionally been kind of like 50-50, but I think you lean towards the Hunter nowadays based off of the way it just curves well. And Rogue seems to be getting away from the consistency. You know, you have Assassin's Blade sometimes. You have two oils, and you just have awkward hands a lot because you're favoring more of the firepower and less of the... Like, the old days of Miracle Rogue was like so consistent because everything drew or had board impact, and nowadays it's more like combo-ish stuff.
Yeah, it seems far from consistent to me nowadays. This is a little bit looks from judging from the Houndmaster and the freezing drop. It's going to be a mid-range Hunter, so that improves the matchup for the Rogue. Because landing something like a sap on a high main can win the game. Against base hunters, it's so tough to win against Rogue Rogue.
Yeah, I mean, and you know, hybrid.
It's hard.
Yeah, I think it's always been the weakness of Rogue, and it hasn't really changed.
Wow, both explosive and freezing.
So, are we looking at hybrid with a more mid-rangey twist than usual hybrids, or are we looking at an actual mid-range Hunter that seems to be running explosive on top?
Yeah,
I have no idea.
I think it's more the mid-range Hunter, because I'd be very surprised if hybrid Hunter ran Hunter's Mark. This doesn't seem like to fit its plan. Hybrid Hunter is like excels at being able to take the board and choose to be aggressive or defensive.
Mm-hmm.
And then Hunter's Mark is more like board centric. Use the early game trades to set up for the mid range approach. Although still realistically, it could be either one. I'd be surprised if that was the case.
I guess some months ago, like half a year ago or so, it wasn't that rare to see both explosive and freezing. But now it's usually only one of the two.
Yeah, how good is explosive nowadays anyways? Even decks that it used to be good against, Zoo, for example. It's like Zoo has so many better ways to deal with it. Not only the eggs, but Imp Gang Boss is more resilient against it. And if you kill their Void Caller with the explosive trap, then like Doomguard or worse comes out.
Yeah, and also it against Patrons and everything, it just gives a Warrior armor easily if there's an armor smith. Duplicates the Patrons.
Yeah, like, what is it good against? Like, what is Explosive Trap supposed to counter? Another Hunter player would probably get a bit of a problem running into it. But then again, with the amount of weapons they have, it's like...
So good against early aggro decks. Aggro Paladin, like, you need to
shut
it down against it. Yeah. Even then, they have Blessing of Kings. But generally speaking, you need to answers like that. It's also good against Shaman, but I don't really know... How common we'll be seeing that. But I just want to throw it out there because you asked a question.
Yeah. On the 22nd, maybe something will come out and suddenly Shaman will be, you know, amazing. I'd love to see it. I don't know what's coming on the 22nd. Speculation-wise, if a good Shaman card comes out, maybe the deck will come back for a little while before it gets, phased out again.
Shaman isn't that bad of a shape. Like, it's not that far from being viable. And the Hero Bar is kind of great, although it gets punished by Unleash and things like that. But still, like, it's not bad.
Yeah, it's like you spawn a totem, you feed Patron an AoE target for their frozing so you die faster. So it feels like the Paladin and Shaman get punished a bit too hard by Patron by design, and that might be what's holding them back a little bit from, pure viability.
I think that the biggest problem is with Overload, because the upside from the Overload cards, like the power level of the Overload card, is not high enough to justify losing the mana crystals for the following turn. I think that's the biggest thing right now.
Well, it used to be, and then...
Yeah, it used to be good, and then suddenly people realize there's power creep, and then Overload didn't quite match up with that, so...
Feral Spirits is a good example. It used to be good.
Yeah, then 3-4 used to be sick. Came out. Or Pilot Shredder came out. It's like, I trade with both of your minions and I still have
two. And I still have a tutor.
Whoa!
I'm on Skype.
Bill Gates stopping by and saying hi. I like that hold on an attack. A lot of players might feel tempted as a rogue to drop like the weapon hit on the Haunted Creeper instead of a better Fan of Knives, but you could get easily punished by Houndmaster. And he's just taking a very defensive approach. And I like that because the Rogue really can't afford to waste too much health against Hunter. It's one of those classes where, as a weapon class, you generally try to, take some blowback Noxious in order to average the board. But against Hunter, you have to be really careful not to do it too much.
Yeah, I think it's the one class that can really punish you for blowbacking too much. Yeah, and that's what they excel at, really. And they've perfected the art of punishing blowback to a point of ridiculousness. I managed to actually say blowback 3 times in less than 1 minute.
Yep.
That's impressive.
Yeah, I'm not sure what to think of that.
My blowback. What's my blowback rate?
Oh my god. So do you play the spinner here? Changing the subject.
Do you think dealing with the shredder or just presenting your own shredder? Because what's the drawback here of playing your own shredder? Your opponent might be able to get some major tempo.
The hunter's mark is if you really want to. But I like the notion you've got. I think it's just weak to sap. It's like the only thing it's really weak-ish to. But at the same time, you can come back on the board fairly effectively. It's not really a problem.
It's like not piloted shredder.
Yeah, a silent
shredder. All right, silent shredder.
It's a very silent pilotless shredder.
Actually, she might be the pilot, and the shredder actually has it, like maybe the shredder is actually just a 2/2, like a 2-drop, and she's actually the pilot. That would explain a lot.
It would, it certainly would. Well, in here you can put out Void Caller, and you can coin out the Abusive Sergeant. Get easy.
That's crazy.
Grades.
That is crazy.
I would love to see that.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I think that's just too good to pass.
One thing you do have to always keep in mind is that Priest has the best way to deal with Void Caller for its mana slot response, which is Shadow Madness.
Yeah, and I mean, Sixo is not far off from Cabaling that Imp King boss.
Yep, that's also true. And like, those are some of the cards that allow Priest to really commandingly seize back forward.
Yep.
So, if he's in tune... He obviously would rather the 2/4 die, right?
Well, yeah. I mean, I'd imagine you try to do that, but either way, you're kind of feeding the Cabal no matter what. The thing is, if the Doomguard comes out, you're forcing Shadow Ward Death, in which case Cabal is a bit less.
Which is fine.
It's a bit of a misplay. Yeah. Miss one damage. You could have traded the Abusive first, because he's trading anyway, even after that trade. So you would have guaranteed that Juggle on phase.
You're
right. You did miss one damage.
Oh, wow. For turn 7, that's not too bad if you pick up the Imgang boss right now.
That's probably one of his better plays. And then he's also worried about Shadow Word Death on the Doomguard, but he can always do that next turn. Mm-hmm. Also, the Imgang boss is funny because the way it interacts with Knife Juggler, and you know, it might create more 1/1s for you to fight back.
Yeah, and then it spawns 1/1s that die to Wild Pyro, so another really good combo. Like up there with Muster for Battle and Unleash the Hounds.
Hey, sometimes you just gotta to clear the board. Desperate times calls for desperate measures. Is it even worth playing Void Caller when you don't have any demons in hand? Or would you tap?
Yeah, I would just throw it there. I mean, even if there's some kind of massive board clear, like how good is the...
Light Bomb?
Well, it's pretty good, but he has the Dr. Boom to follow up. Because of the Dr. Boom in his hand, I don't think it's as important to... I don't like that trade if he's going for that one. I think he should just push him. But I guess it would be a little bit less weak to Shadow Ward Death. But if the Doom card gets Shadow Ward Death, then the Dr. Boom is likely to not...
Yeah.
I think this is good. Just going face.
Yeah, but look, the Wild Pyromancer value wasn't too bad. Actually, at this point, it's pretty rough because that second Shadow Ward Death is the most clutch draw.
Yeah, that was
amazing. Ever. Yeah. With the Wild Pyromancer, that's a clear on Dr. Boom. You do take some damage though, which is rough. But this could be a turning point in the game where Priest is able to swing it back.
Yeah.
That was such a huge deal. Oh my goodness. Let's see.
Okay.
I guess the drawback is if the Wild Pyro dies, then suddenly the way you had to handle Dr. Boom super well is kind of... It's mitigated slightly. Not by much, but...
Yeah, he's avoiding a confrontation with Void Caller this turn. He doesn't want to evoke the wrath of another demon. And we all know that this is when you draw Mal'Ganis. And
win, yeah.
Not too happy about that.
Well, he does pick up a demon at least. No, it's not bad. It's going to protect those little Boombots, if he wants them to.
Better than summoning nothing from your hand, right? Because that was the case beforehand. Oh man. Shadow Word Death number two, though.
Yeah, that's a sick one, too.
Okay, unless...
I'm listening.
Wait, is there a scenario where he could just die? Yeah, okay. So if he, boombots and does at least eight damage, then he can't heal himself back up to five, and then he'll have a Void Walker on board plus Power of Allowing for five damage.
Wow.
That's the way this could be, like, completely out of Sixo's hand. RNG just got them, and there's nothing he can do about it.
I mean, do you even have... Like, you can always heal yourself, can't you?
Yeah, so what you do is you Shadow Word Death here, and then you'd Holy Nova or heal yourself, and you go back up to 5 if the Boombot hits your face for 8. And then you Void Walker comes out because of Void Caller.
Why do you Nova?
Nova or, you know, if you want to increase your chances of hitting Boombots hitting other targets.
Okay.
It doesn't really matter.
All right, well, here we go.
Yeah. So if the boom hits 8 for 8.
Yeah, you've got it.
Actually, no, he healed a minion, so if it hit for 6.
Ooh!
Wait.
Oh, man.
He's one off lethal.
It's the one damage that he missed earlier.
Oh
yes,
he missed one because the jackal trading broke.
Damage.
One off lethal force and never lucky. What a clown. Fiesta.
That's right, man.
What are you doing, man?
Oh, no.
this is the scenarios where it's like you really feel like it's one damage. How much could it hurt?
Yeah, against priest, I still have to go against like 17,000 healing. So
okay, here's another thing though. Both Shadow Word Deaths have been used, and he knows that his opponents also like use Blob Pyromancer, so it's becoming increasingly more difficult for his opponent to.
But Cabal, man. Cabal with the Valence Chosen on the Void Walker. That's like a really intense taunt.
Yeah, and then they silence it, though.
Yeah.
Or even, Powerbombing should be able to push through it, right?
Well, it might push through. Well, then again, it's going to be on 6 health. I mean, it's going to push through it, but the opponent's... He's then going to have, like, a small window of opportunity to stay alive.
Mm-hmm.
Which he would be dead if the juggle had been had thrown the knife.
Oh man.
If this game is actually gonna go to Sixo, this is gonna be this is the one damage that matters.
There's gonna be Reddit posts and there's gonna be some videos.
Yeah, with some, you know, EDM in the background with some text to speech voice.
Of course. Thank you.
And some memes. And yeah, you know it. And some people yelling, oh, that ain't Falco.
The video's gonna be called One Dank Off Lethal.
Now he's subject to any kind of buff that kills him again. Yeah. But it does remove the most power on the board.
Like half the deck from Force and kills him. Well, that's not it.
Okay, so anything that does 2 damage.
Oh!
That is not what he was looking for. And actually, this play was probably the right one.
Does he Power Overwhelming and kill off something now? Or does he just go face with the damage?
Thing is, P.O. could pop the egg right now, but you know it's going to be popped if he plays Nova anyway. Thing is, it's going to give him the initiative to then answer with the wolf.
I think I like damaging the... The thing is, like, the only out that your opponent would have if you draw like Doomguard number 2, because you have to think about the ways you end the game, is that if he has Light of the Naru, because he already used both of his like the defensive cards here with Shadow Word Death, so it doesn't even really matter anymore. I like hitting the face.
Yeah,
he has to. And also, the Haunted Creeper might even survive whatever AOE he has, so you even have the 1/1s they're attacking, which might be relevant here.
Oh, wow.
Sinjin. Wow.
These cards.
He also has a 3 damage Valence Chosen, which allows him to
weaken the end a bit further.
Yeah, like even start potentially pushing for lethal in the next turn. Like he has to kill this 4/1 obviously, but then I think he just push face from that point on, right?
Yeah, with that 5/5, because you're setting up for lethal next turn if you do that, so. Like, what could he even do to go through Senjin? It has to be a silence, and if he goes for the silence, he then has to tap into another damage source, because otherwise he's not dealing four. So it's like a back-to-back owl plus damage source.
And this one owl is already spent to
get
it early on the stolen Imperium Ghost.
If you trade with a 1-1 and he draws Implosion, then you lose a lot of damage and you don't have lethal anymore. I like this attack more. Mal'Ganis. But, I mean, Mal'Ganis just still doesn't necessarily guarantee him TM anything. It's just stalling out.
It lets you tap for free, assuming it even lives, which it won't. But, I mean, the way this is going to play out, it's going to come down to like one turn where Forsen actually gets to play something relevant. Because otherwise he's dead on board next turn, no matter what.
Oh, wow. Those cards don't do anything right now. There's no immediate impact from any one of those.
Yeah, Ysera might be his best chance. But then Pyotr allows him to heal, actually. No. What also really sucks is both these plays are 9 mana total. Okay, you know what? This makes a lot of sense if he's trying to clear the board here, because Ysera wouldn't allow him to push for lethal.
Oh.
But there is nothing it could actually win here. Like nothing.
No. Implosion on the Shredder.
Oh, you're right. Implosion on the Shredder. You're right. The hope is real.
Oh, man. He has to first roll 3 or higher.
Oh, and that one miss damage actually cost him the game.
Yeah, that's a miss lethal from very, very early in the game. Oh, man. Yeah. You know when you miss lethal on turn 4 and the opponent has 28 health? This is kind of what happens.
How often does that happen?
Only the Forsen. Rule number one.
Well, to be fair, that's what makes supposed aggro decks. It's not even really an aggro deck as much anymore, but that's what makes them. That's their drawback, because a seemingly small mistake like that could cost you the game.
Yeah.
Now, guys, both priests have won a game, and they both went 1-2, but overall got the job done, because the 6-deck slot is always the hardest for teams to come up with. And now we have a good old Hunter, Warrior, Warlock versus Hunter and Warrior. So lots of the power classes coming up here.
Yeah, the biggest ones, actually. I think those are kind of the most common classes that you'd go to. Like, if you were to do a smaller format, you know, that's not best of 11, people would still bring those classes most of the time.
Yep.
It's true.
Yeah, I'd say so.
I'm kind of happy in a way that we got the priests out of the way, because it's even though it creates stories and stuff, I wouldn't enjoy it that much if somebody just 0-6 with a priest. I think it's nice to see like more balanced out match.
Yeah, I definitely agree.
Say so too, and I'd like to see like Zalay also succeed with the Patron Warrior, because I think he's been catching some heat from fans and his teammates about his Patron play. I think they've been very like hard on him, and rightfully so, because Zalay has been one of the best Patron Warriors since the inception of his deck. He got to number one on both Europe and North America simultaneously with the Patron Warrior deck. So he's more than capable of playing at his maximum capacity and not missing any of those damages and lethals there.
Yeah. On the upside, he can't be benched.
At least not in this series. He has to win 2 out of the next 4 games. Yes, 2 out of the next 4 games. Otherwise, if he doesn't go, he goes to the 5th game and he loses, he's in trouble.
Yeah. No. I could imagine the Forsen might now struggle with that zoo of his. Like, that was the one that he needed to win. Well, both the Hunter and the Warrior are not great for it.
Yeah, I think the zoo is definitely going to be able to take a win here. I mean, I think Hybrid Hunter has a better matchup than the other archetypes against zoo. It's like the only one that I really see having, you know, kind of a coin flip matchup against zoo, if not a favorable one sometimes. But the moment you go to the extreme of midrange or face, suddenly the matchup becomes a lot worse. So, yeah, definitely a good matchup for Forsen.
Oh, you like Warlock versus Hunter? I'm not sure.
I would lean towards the Hunter for sure.
Yeah, I hate facing against Hunters that ever get board control ever against you. Because there's two hero powers that Hunters have.
Interesting. I really like the Zoo against midrange. I think it's one of the few matchups. It's the one I like if I'm going to be going up as a Zoo player against a Hunter. Mm. I think you win like a lot of the matches against them.
It can be faster than the mid range Hunter is, so it's possible, it's doable. It's just some cards like Implosion are not very good against Unleash the Beasts, and when Juggler Unleash or something similar happens, it's such a big deal.
In fact, if it's mid range, part of the challenge is that the tempo that you gain can easily be going the opposite direction. Like you said, Implosion, and then Hunter has like really strong resilient value cards, and then even simple stuff like Hunter's Mark and Freezing Trap like makes you in a really awkward spot. But that said, if you ever get like a really resilient board and you can get like a really nice defender of Argus off, I mean, Warlock is really powerful still. So don't underestimate it.
That's just not a great hand though. Like at the moment, this is just not the kind of hand you're looking for when you're playing a Zoo.
So much better for the Hunter. Like the Hunter hand is quite amazing.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. This is horrible for the Zoo player. It's one of the few times where like there's absolutely no curve staring you down. And when you're playing Iron Beak Owl as a curve play, I mean it's not bad here, but let's just say it's not amazing either.
Is it always Huffer, guys? Because if it's Huffer in this scenario, I wouldn't be too happy.
Yeah, really bad.
But if you go for the creeper to get a safer Houndmaster play, I feel like you're just foregoing your curve too much. So I think maybe one time, just today, it's not Huffer. That's kind of what I'm sensing here, because the Animal Companion play feels like the best for the board presence, although the weapon does open up plays the next turn, too.
But on the other hand, even Leok and Misha would get traded easily with the Owl if there was an abusive Surgeon.
Yeah. True. You're
so I wouldn't hate the bow here.
Yeah. Actually, if that's the case, then perhaps you can go for that safe play.
Oh.
Okay.
Well, he disagrees with
the guarantee.
This is good because the Houndmaster gives value.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. I'm not sure what to think of that. It's kind of nice, but Unleash is such a valuable card.
Yeah. Well, you see Implosion in hand for Forsen.
Yeah. So like he's going to get punished by the Implosion pretty hard.
It's not that. I can see why Zalay wants to go for the guarantee. Mm-hmm. And to be honest, we've all been in that position relying on Animal Companion. It's just like, you know, it's just not there sometimes for you.
Now Forsen is going to roll a 2.
If it rolls a 2, it's such a big thing. Like 3 or 4 is not as meaningful, but if it's a 2.
Alright,
got it this time.
The Unleashed already gone too, so that's going to be pretty good for Forsen.
This is where he was supposed to unleash, but nope.
Yeah, 3 or 4 didn't really have too much significance unless he got Mal'Ganis out. With some Void Caller plays, but it's still very nice because he has Defender of Argus, and so he has multiple targets to kind of attack and push into. And Zalay here is now a little bit in an awkward spot where he drew his second weapon. I'm like, what's that going to do against the board?
Yeah, what do you hit with the weapon? There's nothing to hit with it.
There's always the face.
Yeah, when it's the place, I mean,
everybody has the fast faces.
Yeah, if you don't know where to attack, this is one of the first rules I've ever been taught playing Hearthstone. If you don't know where to attack, hit the face.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. I think it's a good rule. I think it's the basis for many decks.
Yeah, you know, they joke that it establishes dominance, but it does put some fear in the heart. It's like, well, you just attack the face, even though there might have been a good trade for you to be defensive. Should I be worried? And then they start making some really weird plays too because they're afraid of what the implication of you attacking them so aggressively.
So like the guy probably has double pop whelming soulfire, so I should probably start trading.
Exactly. Well, Forsen ends up just going ahead and picking off a little bit of trades, trying to cash in on his implosion before maybe a second unleash or a knife juggler comes out here with some massive damage.
Yep.
That defense of Argus is looking very dangerous, though.
Oh, yeah, it's juicy. Super juicy. Wow. You have two super high-value demons and one, like, reasonable value. Even a Voidcaller summoning Inbank boss is pretty nice.
Yeah, and well, it's looking at the other two, it's not that great. I was just thinking, because he will have 6 mana. And it's quite important to get that Inbank boss out of the hand, because you really don't want to pull it. Like, it's not bad, but Mal'Ganis, right. Doomguard... Like those win the game.
Game winning plays.
Yeah. And the hunter's got a lot of damage. He can start pushing. Like if he weaves in the shredder here, instead of going for the bow, you know, shredder hero power, and then you start attacking your opponent, and then suddenly Defend of Argus one turn later starts making no sense because it looks too weak.
Well, here's a valid question though. If you don't get this bow out next turn, you're definitely not getting out the following turn. You're playing Dr. Boom next turn.
Yeah.
So if you're going to be aggressive, and I like being aggressive here because you're putting, again, Warlock down to low health and forcing him in an awkward position, when are you going to ever get these bow out? So I think the Pilot Shredder is a good contingency plan if the board ever goes completely kaput. And setting up for Dr. Boom with the bow is also better for board control purposes. So I'm pretty happy with this.
Yeah, I kind of liked it as well. If they played the Shredder, the Void Caller would have a perfect trade with it and just pull a bigger demon out. Like, now there's no way to kill off the Void Caller just yet.
Well, though, I mean, there is the Hunter's Mark still existing in the deck somewhere. We saw that when Zolay played it in Game 6 up against the Rogue from Muskaka.
No, I meant like the Warlock wants to kill it off.
Oh, correct.
Better demon out. Yes, like, the Hunter does not want to kill it.
Yeah. Huh.
Oh,
Dr.
Wow.
Boom almost looks like you want to play it, but then you look at the board and you're like, it's not nearly as impactful as I want it to be right now.
Yeah. But I mean, the borders are green. You have Dr. Boom. Go.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And it's glowing green, you play it.
It really feels like the best chance to win, too, because if he crashes the board, because you know the Warlock, if he has a demon, will sort of want the Void Caller to die sometimes. And you can get past these taunts, you have more damage to end the game potentially.
I think he has to play. What would be a winning play? I don't think any of the other cards make any sense though.
No, you're right.
No, because you can't. You already swing with the bow this turn anyways.
Yeah.
If Eaglehorn Bow could attack twice and had Wind Fury, maybe you can make a case for it, but not in this scenario. I think Dr. Boom.
Just put your faith in the boom bots and go flippers.
Put your faith in the boom.
Put your face
boom
in
the boom bots.
Put your boom in their face.
Oh,
that's looking good. So actually, the double aim gang boss allows you to get either of the two demons out guaranteed, and suddenly things are looking a bit cooler.
What's great about it too is that they're also high value targets for boom bots in a sense, because if they hit him anything less than 4, it creates more minions on the board. So it helps you improve your power, and you can even kill Dr. Boom pretty effectively this turn. You are worried about your health count, but when you have Mal'Ganis, you're just
really wants the Mal'Ganis out here, not the Doom, but I think the Mal'Ganis would kind of seal the game up.
Yeah.
Since there's unless he top decks the Hunter's Mark.
Yeah, or IMBK, I'll leave
him. Well, he can even clear the board after. No, he can't. Yeah. That would have been devastating.
This is a really important trade.
It is. Because if the Doom card comes out. Oh, but it did. There is a chance for Zolay to still take this.
Yeah.
Zolay with the 8 damage in his hand, 4 on the board. If that boom box.
No, man.
Don't do it. Don't do it, man. He's so close to lethal too. God.
But he has no beast.
So short of the damage. Is it going to be an RNG turn where you hope? Thing is, Mal'Ganis can't come down now. It's impossible.
Yeah, he's also worried if he's going to die next turn, which he will on board. But if he eliminates, like if he hits into the wall. Actually, if he hits the face for enough damage.
Oh, is that enough?
Wait.
One off.
He's one damage off. Two. Ten.
Forcing his face palming. He's like, there's no way this is happening to me again.
Well, right now, the tables have turned. Zolay is one damage off lethal.
Yeah. Oh, man. Okay.
Oh.
That does more harm than good.
Yeah.
When this next team to deal with. How much damage does Forsen
have? He's not dead yet, 14. Though. Even if he's gonna be one up.
So, put him down to. Down, so he can. Up. Oh, but he. Okay.
Yeah. So he's gonna swing and hit the face, and then put it down to kill command kill, anyways.
Okay. He can do it. He can
this
do
is,
it.
This is really good. Because power overwhelming would be one off.
I don't even know what.
So it has to be the last Doom card, or two cards.
Oh,
he's got to tap into something else then.
He's gonna have to find an answer right off the top.
If he puts his faith in the Void Walker, well, it's gonna
what
lose.
Do you, what can you even top deck anyway? Like Void Caller, then you.
God. Has to be the Doom God.
Yeah, you're right. It has to be.
Yeah. Only way. Unless he plays a Lotep. No, Lotep would help. It would help. Right? No, it wouldn't.
Yeah, yes, it would. Yes, it would.
Happen.
Oh, would. You're right. Because he taps at 3 health.
So the only way to win is to tap into the last Doom God.
No, he makes the trade. Putting his faith in the Voidwalker is gonna suffer.
Man, for it. That is another win for Team Archon now. And he's not happy to see second kill command, which is unlikely based off of the way Hunter drew, but ends up being the case here. And Archon is at match point.
That boombot. Oh. That boombot.
That's boombot.
Well, I mean, it was either doing one damage or two damage in that case, and it ended up doing the two damage. Yeah. Really close stuff, but that's really funny given the odds of hitting out of those five targets hitting the face.
Well, I mean, yeah. Forsen, I mean, he did miss lethal in the previous, well, miss lethal. Let's not put it that way, because there was no miss lethal effectively, but he missed that one damage, and that could have gotten him the win, and you'd be not having to replay that zoo again.
Yeah, it's true.
Well, the snowball effect is like real. Now it's two games because of that one missed damage.
Yeah.
All right. Well, that means Warrior has three chances up against Warlock, Hunter, and Warrior himself. Mm-hmm. The worst.
Forsen is locked out now. Is locked out. He lost two games in a row.
He's benched.
Yep.
Benched, yes.
So Chucky has his Hunter, which feels like 50-50, although we don't know what kind of Hunter it is. It could be super aggressive, it could be more of a defensive mid range. Oskaka also could be bringing out Control War. We haven't seen it all series yet.
No, we haven't seen it yet. He's only played the Rogue and got one win, one loss with it.
Yeah, so it could still be either one. I think we might be about to find out.
There was a tweet from Shocky saying, "I got my first loss in the ATLC. I'm counting on the Shocky boy, the Forsen boys to carry me." It's like, well. 5-3. It's kind of there's a lot of pressure here. I mean, Patron is the type of deck that wins against anything just out of nowhere. Maybe they're gonna go for the because you can't put if it's Face Hunter, you're not pushing it at all. So you might go for the coin flip with both Patron Warriors being played.
Yep, I think that's the case. Two Warriors. Control would be a huge surprise.
All right, well, Control Warrior versus Control Warrior is a very slow matchup, and in the interest of having the broadcast end today, I think it'd be good if one of them was Patron.
What is about the Face Warrior? You forgot about that one, man. You can't discount the Mortal Strikes until you see...
Oh, yes, I can. Have you seen Sludge Belcher? And have you seen Arcanite Reaper? Like, have you seen that interaction ever happen one time? You know Face Warrior died the day Nax Ramis came out.
Yeah. What do you mean? Annoyotron's not bad enough.
Yeah, it's true. It's just like, oh man, whenever I try playing Face War and then I see Sludge Belcher come out, I'm like, oh, that's right. That's why I don't play this class.
They need to give more removal to Warriors where they can actually kill taunts right away. Like in one shot. Silence and destroy a taunt minion.
Yeah. All right, well, we have what looks like to be Patron Warriors on both sides here. Zalay is the one that has the coin and the Emperor. Is it ever worth keeping something like the Emperor? Because it could be super valuable. Or do you value draw so much early on that that's more important thing?
I'd keep Emperor, but then again, yeah. Who am I?
Depends on the matchup. In some matchups, if you know you're against Aggro, you should throw it back. But I'm almost certain he's going to keep it here. Because he's up against another Warrior. There won't be things to fire your Aurex or anything. So he doesn't need to dig for a weapon that aggressively.
Yeah, and he's also got the Patron in his hand after the mulligan, so that's one of the biggest pieces that he can use in this deck, because there's really no way for the enemy Warrior to handle your Patrons.
That's true.
It's like it's one really of the few matchups.
Both players with only minions in hand. Oh, and there's one weapon, but no spells.
Yeah, there's one weapon. Wow, that's exciting.
Well, really? It's just classic Warrior versus Warrior, and you know, for all the other person can guess, it still could be Control Warrior, too. Like, yeah. You know, like, do I, am I, you know, is it Control Warrior? Do I have to be really careful? Do I have to be aggressive? I mean, it's hard to tell. And this Acolyte can't get punished versus Zalay's Acolyte will get
really
punished
good.
If he goes for it.
Yeah. It's really scary to drop an Acolyte in there because then if if Ostgaka had a Inner Rage or a Cruel Taskmaster, his acolyte would end up drawing three, and Zalae would only get one card.
Yeah, but then again, you've got the Emperor, so I guess even if you draw just one card, you're still gonna be happy because you're gonna draw off the Gnomish and then possibly follow it up. But you're right; I think Cruel Taskmaster and Inner Rage would be very big problems here for Zalae.
Well, I mean, and more importantly, it's like, you know, there's this thing where you don't want to fall too hard behind the card count. Plus, even drawing with one on the Acolyte is kind of okay because you have two Gnomish Inventors and Emperor Thorsen to reduce a bunch of cost. Yeah, so I can understand why, but at the same time, you know, you did end up getting punished. Now there's a Deathbite out there challenging whatever comes out. Plus, if, you know, other things come out like Grim Patron, Inner Rage, Whirlwind.
Yeah. I don't know, this weapon here is going to be fairly effective, but it's not going to be able to give you... I mean, he's going to get at least one patron out of it if he wants to copy it, and that's going to force Zalae to respond to it. You know, if Ostgaka decides to pop the weapon, he's getting the initiative on it. I mean, sure, the opponent's got the Emperor Thorsen for a better potential turn, but at the moment, he's got the initiative, and in this matchup, very often, that's all it takes.
Yeah, but you don't...
Oh, wow! This is insane.
That is such a good card to get. Yeah, I was about to go for two patrons. It's not enough. You need the four, and that's it. Then
and he draws a card.
Good so, game.
Like, if he picks up another way to like really seal it in terms of like board control, then there's really no way to deal with it.
You mean Warsong Commander Whirlwind's not enough with
this
the axe?
It's almost impossible to deal with.
Right.
I mean that helps.
That helps you deal with three patrons.
No, you can kill three.
Oh, okay, you mean Zalae? No, I don't think Zalae's got... I mean, he's got Slam, Execute, he's got a Whirlwind, so he can kill three of them, but...
Yeah, Execute...
The Execute Slam, sorry. Execute Slam, Deathbite. That's not bad, but...
I think...
Like, just Emperor and hope to top deck a Warsong. I don't know. This looks so much pressure.
I would play Deathbite Slam Execute here. I'm too scared of anything else.
Not enough mana for all that.
You can just execute Inner Rage Deathbite. It does the same.
Oh, yeah, Inner Rage can do it. Inner Rage. Slam. He's slamming over it there.
Yeah, you keep the Execute then, so he can.
But I'd keep the Inner Rage for my own patron for the following turn, because I'm popping everything up. Unless you don't want to use the Execute here.
Yeah, I actually kind of like... I really like that, like keeping the Inner Rage there. Because the Deathbite would have still cleared everything. And it's likely that the Ostgaka is going to kill that 5-1 himself anyway with another Whirlwind effect. I would have really loved to see him keep the Inner Rage in that situation. Like, okay, the 5-1 can't duplicate anymore anyway.
Yeah, as far as he knows, no one's healing
He couldn't kill the 3-3 in that case. It's kind of an awkward position for Zalae, but I think he's getting out of it pretty well if you look at the board and the hand that they've got. Like, it hasn't gone out of control yet. I mean, the Whirlwind's gonna make it so Ostgaka's gonna draw all the cards.
Oh.
Yeah, I mean, now you're back to the same problem as before. He's drawing more cards. There's another Grim Patron on the board. Deathbite doesn't kill it all. You have to execute it, and then you're spending so much of your turn removing that it's like really awkward. And here's another thing too. If you use Deathbite to remove,
oh, you're fine.
You're giving him more
it.
Cards.
No, you execute the 3-2, you attack the 3-3 after playing your own patron. And now let the Ostgaka deal with that.
If he only kept the Inner Rage, he could get four patrons himself now while clearing all of Ostgaka's.
Oh man, there's so many little things here with those patron mirror matches. It's crazy.
It's a really good point to bring up, considering that it gave him board dominance over a bunch of one attack minions. It'd be a 1-1 acolyte and a 1-2 armor smith. Now, what's funny enough is that you never know on the opposite end if your opponent has Warsong and Unstable Ghouls and Frothing Berserkers. As the game develops, you have to be somewhat cautious with how you develop your board because then your opponent can reverse kill you right back.
Yeah, life coach style.
Life coach style. Indeed.
Well, speaking of the devil, there's no patron at least, but the Frothing Berserker could be a big issue soon.
Yeah, but he's got a very easy kill on it. You know, he can first battle rage. First, you battle rage, draw a lot of cards.
Oh, yeah, he can feel his hand here. Yeah. Back to full.
Then, Cruel Taskmaster and Fire War Axe allows you to clear the board.
Mm-hmm.
Seems really good.
Yeah, I played. I was casting at a tournament in Vulcan. I think there was some player made the mistake of trying to whirlwind off his opponent's patrons.
Ha! We've all been there before. The very first day I faced against patron, it's like I also didn't realize. I didn't realize that like patrons die and before they don't copy before they die. So I had a full board and I kept whirlwind queuing. And I kept killing my own patrons, and by the end, I had like two patrons on my board.
After killing them all.
Because I whirlwind too much, and I ended up like.
That's what you get for committing Sudoku.
Everyone was like learning in the first few days. So
it's yeah.
All right. So interesting. It makes a little bit more aggressive line of play.
Sure.
Adding minions. Well, I mean, why not?
Yeah, I like it because it makes it less vulnerable to a few things. The Warsong Grim Patron or something, you know, there's less minions that are weak on the board. Also, if the Whirlwind effect comes out, it kills his minion once, so there's less opportunities for Frothing Berserkers to do a lot of damage too. So I like it's a very good mix of play. It's overall stronger on a lot of levels.
Yeah, it's pretty good.
Now the question that Zoli's asking himself is, how do I clear the board and get rid of the Warsong Commander at the same time? Because that thing can't stay. Again, it's like, do you just fire War Axe on Stable Ghoul and leave it at that?
Might even just Gnomish Inventor, because like you need to, but like yeah. Draw cards.
It's weird to play them stable, but I guess he's fearing for his life total.
Yeah, he actually that's a good point. He might just die. Gromash, for example. No, he still dies to Gromash. Doesn't even matter.
Yeah.
Does he?
Does he?
Oh wow! Actually, he just died to that.
He would, because of the armor.
So... Do it right.
Oh wait. Warsong, Frothing, Ghoul, or Whirlwind Effect, rather.
So all the ghouls are gonna go off. Yeah, that's easy enough. There's not that many minions. Like, those are gonna die on the first wave.
Yeah, but the Acolyte represents 2 damage.
No.
So.
Yeah.
Well, it's not enough to kill your opponent, but I think it's gonna be enough to put him in a really weird spot. At the very least.
2, 4, and then the Whirlwind Effect would be on.
Bump them, yeah.
That's a 7, 10. 13. Plus another Whirlwind. On 2, I count 14 damage?
I think one of the minions dies. I think it's down to 12. I don't know, we'll see exactly. It's kind of like
wait, no, this Acolyte attacking is really big. I think that gives him extra damage.
That's what I said, it's like, it's accounting for 2 extra damage instead of 1. So it's doing, and the Armorsmith also gives you the extra 2 that otherwise would try to go face. And then you can play your Whirlwind on 2 minions. And then punch face for like 12 or something.
Alright.
It'd be 10. Alright.
Yeah, I forgot the minion died, too.
Still pretty good.
You don't get to count those minions in the Whirlwind effect.
But still. Still, that's a really weird position to be stuck in as a lay without an execute.
Yeah.
You're going to be pushing for that draw.
He has to draw here. Drawing for a way to deal with that. Oh, could he, like, Warsong Gnomish Whirlwind? No, that's so horrible.
I mean, you could do it, but then you're dead to any weapon.
Yeah, I mean, he would leave him down to 3.
Because
he would have to use the weapon to clear off the 2-2.
I think it's left to execute draw, and you have 2 chances to do it.
Yeah, I think so, too. Well, I kind of won, actually, because then he would die to them.
Yeah, I don't know if
he got armor up if he draws twice and executes.
Alright, so...
But he's not a man at the bottom row.
So this has to be execute off the top. No, he doesn't have enough mana to armor.
Okay, this gives him enough mana to armor. But no, it doesn't.
No, it doesn't. Unless he's still about to execute.
No, he does not have enough. Okay, that does it.
Yep, and that means that Forsen Voice is alive. Forsen still up for grabs here, and he's officially unbenched. And Oskaka is also done for the day.
So it's all down to Forsen, isn't it?
No, and Chucky.
And Chucky still has the Hunter, which we haven't seen.
So those 2, yeah.
I have
Forsen with the 2 and Chucky with the Hunter.
I have to imagine the Hunter comes out here from Chucky. The Warlock deck still seems suspect to Patron, in my opinion. I'm not feeling like the early game minions are strong enough, especially when you're looking at cards like Voidwalker and Haunted Creeper ever existing in the Warlock deck.
Yeah, I mean, the thing about that matchup is that the Warlock has to go really aggressive and need to end the game basically before the Warsong and Patron. Because when the Warsong Patron thing happens, it's with all the kind of spiders and things out there, it's just not going to work out. And it might not be fast enough. It's a little bit slower version of the Zoo. He's running the Mal'Ganis, he's running the Void Core instead of the hyper aggressive like double flaming.
Right.
And with Dire Wolves, and there was a Dire Wolf, but it's still a little bit slower. So it might be really rough to end the game before that combo happens.
Yeah, I think it's actually really difficult for Zoo to win anymore. Like against Patron, it's like one of the most uphill battles you can get. Like, is there even a worse matchup for Zoo at the moment in the meta? Like, I can't quite think of one. That feels like the worst, if not like one of the worst, if not the worst.
That's pretty bad. Freeze Mage is pretty bad too.
Right. I think they're like
face most Hunter difficult. Is also horrible. Like face version of Hunter. Mid range is not that bad, but face is really bad.
Mm. Wait, sorry, I missed your question. I kind of cut out. You're saying, is there any...
Yeah, a worse matchup than Patron? Because I feel like Patron's the toughest matchup you'll run into, and then maybe Freeze Mage. Those are kind of like the most difficult.
Those are generally really difficult. Oh, any kind of like defensive mage, even. Grinder Mage is really difficult.
Echo as well.
Echo Giants, Mage is great at aggro.
Mm-hmm. It's all because of the way that Zoo needs to deal its damage with the minions on board instead of from hand like some other aggressive decks do, or with hero power like Hunter does. Mm-hmm. And just the tools to freeze, like any kind of freeze spells are so efficient against it.
Because even defensive classes like Ramp Druid and Control Warrior need to have the right cards at the right time, and it can often be like a coin flip, like, oh, do I have a weapon? Or, you know, oh, do I have Innervate type thing? So
yeah. Exactly.
Here we go. Warlock it is for Forsen. He wants to get this over with and send it to game number 11 with Chalky at the helm at the Hunter. I apologize. I said 5 games is what Delay has to work with. He only had 3 games to work with. I kind of miscounted there. And this is game number 2. So if he loses this game, we have one more game following, in which case Archon could be potentially dropping and Forsen Boy squeak out with the third win and be 3-0, which is huge. Because they don't count how many losses that you have. Ultimately, if you win the series, it doesn't matter what the score is, as long as you get the series points.
Okay, Flame Imp is excellent for Forsen. The big thing here is going to be whether or not Zelay draws the Fiery War Axe. Because if he doesn't find it, that Flame Imp might end up dealing 9 or even 12 damage.
Well, 15 if you count the 3 to the Warlock. He's just the chaos.
Yeah, sure.
Chaos card, man.
Was that the blowback thing?
Yeah, it's blowback. Flame Imp is blowback.
No War Axe here for the Warrior, so that's going to be a bit of a slow start. No Armorsmith either, so no Cruel Task. It's kind of a...
That's exactly what you're doing. You know, this doesn't get it. No. That's Flame Imp. Because now there's going to be new minions coming out every turn, and there's always going to be that one extra that you can't kill.
It's actually higher priority targets, too. Knife Juggler takes precedence over the Flame Imp in terms of dying.
These are going to add up to so much damage. That's a dream start against this. Having those high damage. Ooh! But it's one turn
better
late.
Than ever.
It's still good. It's still good, but it's that critical one turn late. Because now it can't keep up with that. He can kill the Juggler, but the Flame Imp. Flame Imp is gonna keep going.
What if a Voidwalker comes out here? Like, what's your plan? Oh man, he's getting a turn 5 Void Terror into Nerubian Egg. A turn 4 with a coin, that is. No, I mean, it's just insane.
That's pretty amazing.
Yeah.
And you can do it. He knows that there's no Prawl in Zalae's patrons.
Do you feel confident enough to drop something to fight back on the board aggressively, like the Frothing, or would you go for Acolyte to try to get more cards and see if you can get more responses?
That's a really tough call. I'm actually not sure, because I feel like he's falling behind, so he should Frothing. But on the other hand, Death Spite would be such a great card to have, so do you try to maximize your chances of drawing it by playing the Acolyte? I'm not sure.
Yeah, I think ultimately it boils down to like where your execute is going to go, because the Acolyte and the Frothing both enable it. The only difference is like Abusive Sergeant punishes you a bit more now than it did a second ago, because you don't have the Cruel Taskmaster. Like, there's a few little differences here in the way this lines up, but ultimately I think the Frothing is the more board-centric play. It's more immediate.
Really, for Forsen Boy's sake, I'm really hoping that he goes for the Egg going Void Terror. So adding that 7 power, he needs to end the game quickly, and he needs to add that 7 power right now. He is going for it. Absolutely the right play here.
Zelly top decks Whirlwind, plays Acolyte, top decks another Whirlwind, goes face.
I mean, what's really rough is, what's really rough is that there's no like execute activators. Yeah. So there's like execute sitting there is an awesome high value card, but you need to activate it somehow.
Frolling doesn't even kill any of those as it is.
Do you attack the 3/5 then play Battle Rage to draw? Like, is there some kind of Battle Rage play, or are you just trying to play very, very...
I kind of like that one. I mean, I think he has to do the Battle Rage, and the way to do it is by damaging that, and it does enable the execute. It's such a poor execute, though, because you know that there's even bigger things in the deck to execute.
Yeah. So it's good for Forsen here.
To do it.
Yeah. Although, this is a position where, as Forsen, you know one of the Frothings dies to a Whirlwind effect. So at least, you know, that's not a big worry. But there's a lot of damage on the board. Like, if the AoE starts piling up and that second Frothing lives and you're flooding the board, you kind of have to silence. Yeah.
Forsen is looking so good in this. I mean, when you see an execute like this happen, like on a Void Terror, it's I feel like it's the same thing as when you see your opponent do an Ancient of Lore heal on himself.
Yeah,
like,
exactly.
It's just as desperate.
That's a good analogy, I think. There's the Ancient of Lore heal of Warrior.
Because there will be a Dr. Boom and Doom Gust and all. Wow.
Wow, this is actually hilarious to me.
That's frothing.
He's like, I'd like to go phase, but I can't.
Just wait for the commanding shout one day to punish somebody. Where the commanding shout doesn't allow your minion to die this turn, so you're just like commanding shout, whirlwind, death.
Well, it was pretty good. Like when Patron came out, some people were trying it like as a core piece of their deck, but it didn't stick around as a result of it being too situational.
The rat played a lot of it back when he was climbing to number one, but not sure how he feels about it nowadays. We'll have to check up on it. Zalei would love to normally drop Emperor Thorsen and try to get some value back, but he finally draws a weapon a little bit too late. Does he have any room at all to be aggressive? And I don't think so. Does he, Savitz?
No.
I don't see how he picks up anything that kills his opponent. I mean, two Frothings are out. His Patron combo is not coming out next turn, even if he gets like a perfect draw. And he's dead if he doesn't. Mm-hmm. He's dead. Okay. He's gotta have to trade. So he'd be dead otherwise.
Yeah. No, it's not... Why? No, if he trades for the biggest minion, he does.
Yeah, he has to. There's no real choice. So now he's gonna live a little bit.
So there's 7 on the board and 12 in hand. If he picks up a power overwhelming, that would do it.
It's still okay too.
Yeah, not bad at all. Juggler, defender.
Yeah, actually that's pretty good too. Because the one thing that you'd be worried about is like Grim Patron coming back on the board, but the defender buffs the two liabilities.
Yeah. You get both of these two toughness minions.
Yeah.
Three. I think that's really good. At this point, you can just ignore it. I mean, it's going to be trading into something anyway.
Mm-hmm.
Like, why on earth would you trade for it?
There's nothing
juggle. Juggle makes it a little bit like... No, but still. Yeah. With the Doom
Guard. I think you still push, yeah.
Yeah, I think so too.
It's too tempting.
Yeah.
I mean, what it's could come out? Base. Like you said, the Patron.
That will trade anyway.
Mm-hmm. Like if it was later in the game and he had more mana, then you'd be worried maybe about weaving in like an execute on that turn with an Inner Rage, and then he starts getting infinite Patrons, and then you can't come back. But as of right now, it's really just not gonna happen.
Yeah, that should be game. Can he Battle Rage into the Patrons or
unless
something?
Unless he has Brawl, right?
Yeah, Battle Rage Brawl. Here it comes.
Which is very rare in a Grim Patron deck.
Don't think it's in there.
I still think you're the only Patron Warrior I've seen like confidently run Brawl more than one game in a competition before. Savitz.
I don't know if I played it in a tournament. I'm not sure, but I did play some of it on ladder, and it actually worked quite well. It's really good against other Patrons, but that's almost it. But it was just like that day when I played it. I played it all day, and over half the games that they were other warriors, so it seemed like a good inclusion.
Yeah, and I think it's pretty good against Handlock as well. It's one of those things where when you're playing Patron, they will go like full-on aggression, like flood the board as much as they can, and you can punish them for that. So Brawl is a good inclusion in some
circumstances. It's amazing. Like when you do the either turn 5 or turn 6 with 6 Patrons, I mean with 4 Patrons on the board, it just demolishes that if you have a weapon out already. And the value also goes up if you if your opponent doesn't know that you're running.
He's still dead, right?
Yeah, a really cute play to try to reduce the size of the bolt, but he's still dead on board. Yeah. Now, Forsen can choose to take his time. Do whatever he chooses to please. Forsen is done for the day. He's got his two wins.
Yep. Forsen trying to figure out which of the two ways is more BM. I guess the roping is the best one.
Brings it to game 11, guys. And Archon was up 5-3 after Zalay was able to grab a game 8 win, but looks like it's going to be really challenging for him to close this match.
It's all tied up now, and it's going to come down to Chucky's Hunter against Zalay's patrons. Mm-hmm. Such a big deal. Like, this is where it gets intense. There's so much on the line in just one game.
Yeah, and the matchups can be pretty polarized, like, depending on what type of Hunter. We haven't seen it yet, right? So, like, mid-range Hunter is bad, but it's not as bad as Face, like, by a tiny margin. So it really depends on what Shocky brought.
Mm-hmm.
I don't know. We'll
mid-range would be way better. But
I'd be surprised, Shocky, though. I feel like I haven't seen Shocky bring mid-range Hunter in like, ever. I feel like it's always been more Face. But surely he has to have brought mid-range Hunter at one point. I just haven't seen it.
Yeah. Well, I just remember him as a Face Hunter player as well.
Okay.
Like, I've seen him play Hunter maybe 5 times or so, and it's always been Face. It's going to be rough for him if that's the case again.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, like Face with an Ooze deck, just because you can. Be kind of fun.
Okay. Yeah. Well, let us know what you guys think. It's game 11, so whoever wins this will end up taking the victory. Remember, Archon's 1-1, and Forsen Boys are 2-0, so this is a very decisive opportunity for Forsen Boys to continue to be undefeated, join Team Nihilum. And Archon can join the upper echelons of the teams here. Let us know what you think. Hashtag ATLC and join the conversation. Those are who you're rooting for. I'm not sure if either of you guys are cheering for a specific team. As casters, you shouldn't, so don't tell me the answer.
I can tell you the answer. I'm not rooting for a specific team.
Yeah, he wants both to lose if possible. So Liquid have a better chance in the following week.
That sounds like a really pragmatic approach to, you know, rooting for people. But I mean, I like both teams, honestly. I feel like they both play very well. And Forsen Boys, I mean, it's kind of like the underdog going into the event. But at this point, when you've seen them win, you know, 2 weeks in a row, I think the underdog status is thrown out the window.
Yeah, that's true. I agree with that statement. Like, they are not, I wouldn't see them as underdogs in any by any means.
Yeah.
Okay, we can see there's a Lay's hand, but the most more exciting one is the Hunter hand right now. Which we should see in just a second. Roping a little on the mulligans.
Yeah, I think we're just trying to make sure to get the spectating feature to work. Either way, I've been seeing more people like flip-flop on whether or not this matchup is 50-50 or leaning over towards a certain way. I think we're going to have to really see the early game dependent draws. Cards like Harrison Jones does end up helping if it becomes relevant, though, but Hunter doesn't need a weapon to curve out really well and still impact the board.
Yeah, it's not surprising. Anymore. That's true. Mm.
It's surprising how often I've been playing Warrior, Harrison has just been useless. Like, it's supposed to be great, there's weapons in the Hunter. But I've had it happen so many times where it just doesn't do anything. Or it's not even meaningful anymore when you play it. It's too late already.
He needs Glaive Zuka here. Oh, actually, Iron Bukal could sustain the exact same role. I was going to say, Glaive Zuka is pretty much the only top that is getting him out of this without having to waste a quick shot.
Yeah, Glaive Zuka would have been even better, but if he didn't draw the towel, he would have been in horrible shape. Like, which one do you throw away? Quickshot or Juggler?
Yeah. Well, I think Juggler would have been horrible to throw away. Isn't it like a much better card in this case? Because you're basically giving the pool on its own. It's too much.
The quickshot might be needed for the draw at some point too. Work an infiltrator.
Well, you can hope. You can always hope for that Worgen to do what it has to with the juggle.
Yes. This is so tough because if he doesn't make the trade for the ghoul, the whirlwind would just clean it up.
Yeah, Whirlwind would be devastating here. I mean, I guess at least you're playing Shredder into it, so you're forcing him to have the weapon if you do that. So it's really not that bad. But honestly, Zalay's hand is really good against a Hunter. Picked up the Ghoul right off the bat, and then two Armorsmiths and a Slam, which also can be used as a pseudo-removal, even without the card draw. So pretty crazy.
We can see that going for face here would be the best play, but that's such a difficult decision. Like, he would look pretty bad if there was a whirlwind right now.
Mm-hmm.
Just a cool trading into the juggler and whirlwind cleaning to get all that.
Oh, yeah. And I think patron players have been getting more aggressive about their defensiveness against Hunter. Like, there was a post yesterday on one of the forums about how Kalento, against a turn one Leper Gnome, is willing to whirlwind, just that desperate to make sure, or that, you know, that adamant about making sure not to take too much damage from Leper Gnomes. Whether that's the right play or whether or not he just really hates Leper Gnomes, it could be one or the other. But in this case, it ends up being the right play.
I think it's one of those things that you have to evaluate based on looking at your entire hand. Mm-hmm. Like, for example, if you don't have a cruel taskmaster or anything to deal with it on the following turns, you might think of it that way. That if I don't whirlwind right now, it's gonna be there for 4 turns. It's gonna deal 8 damage. So it's like you have to think it long term. Like, do I have a way to deal with it later on if I leave it up right now?
Yeah, that's an excellent way to analyze it for sure. And Chalky even willing to try and shut down the double armor smiths, which is, you know, very, very important, because if his opponent had cool taskmaster, it's gaining like 6 armor, and as the face hunter, you're just not going to be able to do it.
Yeah, so Zale looking crazy right now, but he might still whiff on the draws. It's possible that he doesn't get the things that he needs. But when you're at
HP
against the face hunter on a turn like this.
Yeah, I think if Chalky wants to win, he has to be playing hybrid with, you know, his high mains at the top of the curve. But the thing is, the weapons are also dead as a result of Zale playing that Harrison Jones. You mentioned earlier it was a pretty bad card very often because you don't get to stem the bleeding. But in this case, with the start he had, I think it's going to be much, much more effective.
Yeah, we saw the Vulcan Infiltrator earlier, so that's almost a certain signal that there won't be any high mains coming. We see the Leper Gnomes in the same deck with high mains, but I haven't seen the Infiltrators in the same deck ever.
Yeah, agreed.
Wow, alright.
Saving the Whirlwind.
Because he knows that this is a high priority target for removal anyways.
Ooh, well, that's a good draw. Yeah,
that's a really good draw.
That's as good as it gets. Well, let's not count Chalky out just yet.
Yeah, on top of the fact that we don't know if Chalky is running high mains anymore, the Shredder is already kind of suspect, because if it's truly face, I think they don't really run the Shredder as often. And then Lotheb is already kind of like another red flag. It's like, is this really all damage charging Hunter? Which it could realistically still have Arcane Golems and Wolf Riders, but maybe it does have those high mains and freezing traps.
It's hard to tell. I mean, it could be that he mixed up that one Infiltrator. Like, that's almost the only thing that points to the face Hunter right now. We haven't seen a single Charger yet. But it's just so rare to see an Infiltrator in the same deck. But we'll see. We'll see. It's interesting to see.
Okay.
So, Quickshot, you're probably going to want to keep for the cycle effect. So, do you ever juggle Unleash just for the one card and then see where... Because if it hits the 5-4 with the knife, then at least you keep the Hound.
But then you don't get the hero power.
Right, which is a big deal in a position like this where you're trying to maximize your damage output.
But losing Lotheb might even be worse, I think.
Mm-hmm. Oh, he's just going to push. All right,
that's fine too.
That's actually better, yeah.
By next turn, choice. You should be able to fill out the mana curve. Also, you know what? I really like this too, because now you're putting multiple targets that are worth killing. Like, you need to kill a Lotheb, you need to kill a Knife Juggler, and if you have weapon, you're going to also be receiving some of that blowback. So you need to
stall for all that.
Yeah, yeah. You really need
I can't
to
focus.
Make sure to shut that down as soon as possible.
All right.
That Lotheb might just end up winning the game. This is looking so hard now because Zale probably doesn't play any shield blocks. And both Armorsmiths are already dead. So those like spikes of more HP are not happening. They won't happen ever again. He's not going to heal up like once more. It's gonna be so interesting.
Okay.
That's the battle rage.
Really helpful.
Inner Rage needs to get picked up and he finds
it. Inner Rage draw. That was huge. Yeah.
That was so big.
But now Chalky can maybe cycle his quick shot.
Mm-hmm. Depends on what he gets here.
Oh, both. That's good. That's convenient, sort of. Yeah. Yeah, I mean, I wouldn't say it's great, but it's convenient, sort of.
Yeah, definitely above average. Unless there's the high man, then there's...
Yeah. I mean, now that Harrison Jones has been used, that's another 3 damage that's, you know...
Yeah,
protects and he also protects the panda.
That's a good call, because that panda is going to get to deal 3 extra, it seems.
Yeah, so you make
unless the acolyte charges into it. Or even the gnomish. I mean, you go Warsong gnomish, you draw, and then...
Yeah, I guess that's one way. But then he's not hero boating again.
What about... what about Emperor Thorsen? Because now it's like... You've somewhat stabilized enough of the board. You've already seen enough of the deck where you can kind of guess that it's hybridish. And so it's like he's going to be playing maybe a Charger or something, but then you start having a lot of cheap cards to go to. Is that too greedy to go for that play?
Yeah, I think his life total is so low that he wants to clear off that, and this seems to be the only way to do it, aside from the Acolyte. Okay. You gotta, he has to be scared for his life total. He hasn't seen a single kill command yet.
That's true. That's also true.
Oh, that's true. He probably has to kill her off the Warsong, because otherwise, if he plays the Scientist and...
Well, you can do it. I mean, you just empty your entire hand and cycle. I think you'd quickshot the...
Yeah, quickshot actually is better, yeah.
Yeah, I think very often that's what he does.
So he can even keep the bow if he wants to. No, probably not.
It's still fine because I think you hero power to make sure that you get the damage in. Quick shot is still
important. So you use the bow here to keep the quick shot. It's like maximizing it.
It's still threatening for sure.
It is.
Second patron not helpful.
Well, none of these cards have. Well, Dead Spite is the only with the immediate impact.
How about Thorsen now? Is it still too unsafe? Actually, Thorsen doesn't even do as much as I thought it would compared to the previous turn where you make Patron and the Warsong cheaper.
Yeah, for the following turn when you can start spawning multiple of them, but at this point it's really not that solid.
It doesn't
maybe.
Do as much as you would hope it to do.
Yeah, I don't like it as much this turn.
Probably setting up the Death Spite seems to be the best.
Then the rest of the mana curve also is awkward because then you'd want to armor up and you only have enough to Battle Rage.
That's true.
Yikes!
Oh, he does run a shield block.
Wow.
Well, that's pretty clutch, but assuming it can go to that point.
Well, that was an important draw. I didn't expect him to have it in the deck.
All right, here we go. Kill command off the top. First you kill command and quick shot, though. Oh, no!
Oh, no!
All right, whatever.
So
kill,
close.
Kill command here.
Kill
right?
command.
Kill command would do
just
it.
Just get it. There's two in there.
That would be it. Oh,
Hopper would do it.
No way, he can't do it. There's no way. I refuse. No, he's smiling. He's got it. He's got it. He smiled.
No.
What?
No! He also missed the damage by doing it out of order, unfortunately.
Yeah, I think he was too eager. He was smiling. Yeah. I really thought he had it. I was
my goodness.
Oh. Shocky, stop. Stop doing these emotes with your wrist.
There's shield block.
Yeah, now there's shield block. That could single-handedly determine the outcome of the game.
That is so huge to the shield. But if he didn't have that, he could never attack because there's the explosive trap and all.
Wait.
Oh my.
And now he's got, he's pretty firmly out of it, and I don't think Chalky has any more ways
you know
to
what?
Get the draw going.
I mean, you just start getting yourself those chargers. If you get, that could be good.
Pretty good, but still.
The thing is, maybe that one damage he missed off of Leok will come in and really be a problem.
Mm.
No, that would be too much. What if that decides the game? No way.
Two games for the Forsen boys end up dropping because of it. That'd be nuts.
Just no way.
If this one minion deck. Is less than 3 attack, by the way.
Yeah,
that's another stabilization
board.
Point.
Okay. It is.
He drops the minions before he can Mana Wraith can come out to screw him. I can appreciate that. I've been on the receiving end of Mana Wraith way too many times.
I guess at least you could fire War Axe, worst case scenario.
It's true. This plays around Doomsayer as well.
Mm-hmm.
Nope, not anymore.
Wow. Oh, all right.
Walker.
Sure. In so, what universe is that useful?
Helps him now.
Heroic Strike.
Oh, I forgot about the trap. That's right. Explosive trap helps to duplicate it.
No, Kill Command still not lethal. He needs to pick up a Beast and Kill Command, which at the moment is not looking very likely. But he's not dead yet. He's got a few turns. Like, if he's playing Void, well, he's got like two turns. If he plays like Wolf Rider. Oh, wow.
That's pretty bad.
It is.
The Frothing Berserker now gets buffed significantly. Not to mention that there's a Lorewalker Cho out there that you can't do anything about.
Yeah, buffs if you play something, the Wolf Riders you are dead.
Yeah.
But
he needed this to be a charger, and he needed the next card to be a charger, and that would
and a weapon, yeah, a weapon or a charger.
Kill command, beast and a kill command.
Let's see what this does do is put his opponent within an assumed range of 5 health, because he can put his opponent down to 5 here, and his opponent will take 2 more.
He's gonna be on 3 effectively, so he needs to pick up like an extra 3 from the top.
Exactly, either another weapon with Eagle Horn Bow or a Arcane Golem or Wolf Rider or Leroy or Kill Command. Like, there's actually still a lot of opportunities, but he still needs to play this Exposure Trap, otherwise he's going to be out of range.
But that ruins the charger. Like, if he plays a Leroy, because then Zalae is going to get... No, but he can't play it, probably.
I think
like, Zalae can play it back to counter the chargers. But Zalae is getting a copy, so he could kill the Joel and then play his own Explosive Trap to be protected from every single Wolf Rider. And
yeah, it's true. No, that's very true. How much damage is this? 2, 6, 8, 11, 13.
13, yeah.
13.
I mean, we're not even counting the patron here. I mean, you could play Fire War Axe. And
I see 14 damage.
Unleash? Could unleash? Like, he can't play 5 minions, right? He can't play 5 minions, because then unleash would do it. So you have to play 4 at the very most. It's got to be a weapon plus minion play.
Mm-hmm.
But what did he keep in your hand? Like, you have to be wondering right now, as Zalae is, what did he keep in his hand? Because like, is that a charger that he's trying to punish me with?
Mm-hmm.
The way if I overextend, like, what is it? Now he's safe from unleash. He's not safe from unleash weapon, but there's no weapon that he knows of.
Yeah, both quick shots are gone. This is unless he plays Leroy, I think that this game is over.
Yeah, the explosive trap was his only way to potentially get the Stalled charger, it. But now he's really hoping for a charger. Mad Scientist draw is the.
Would have been so brutal if he threw an Arcane Golem there and was 1-0.
It would have been like this would have been the worst feeling in the world.
Well,
absolutely, that's one that he missed, Leo.
On the flip side, Zalae takes home the victory, and it took 3 tries, but the Patron Warrior did it. And more importantly, it's the fact that Archon was able to take down Force and Boys, a team that's ahead of them in the standings. So, a job well done.
Yeah, this not too bad for Force and Boys either, getting those 5 wins. I think they sit quite comfortably in the standings still.
I mean, this is a really good... They're still in a really good position after losing this week. Like, they're still up 2 wins in the entire series. They're actually, funny enough, I think Archon is equalizing and maybe going a little bit ahead as a result of winning the head-to-head. I'm not sure if that's that accounts for a lot, but they're going to be on the same score.
Mm-hmm.
All right, sounds good. Well, guys, we want to give a big shout-out to the Amazon App Store, as they are here helping us make this team league happen. We're doing a giveaway where you can get $25 extra on top of $25 spent. So if you spend $25, basically Amazon will double down for you with a coupon code. The way to do it is to go to the link. There's some giveaways also being listed on the Twitch profile. Check out. 50 winners will be given away by the end of today. So make sure to get part of that. And you can do it while we take a break, because I believe we're coming up for our second match of the day, which is Team Celestial up against Value Town. I'm not sure we're gonna necessarily rotate Savitz out. I hope you've been having fun casting. Normally, this is where we thank you for hopping back, and then wish you good luck. But we might even have you after the break. We'll see
Hopefully.
How it's going.
Okay.
All right, cool. Well, what we're gonna do is we're gonna take a break, and when we come back, we're gonna continue the Archon Team League Championships. Don't go anywhere. Back in just a sec.